Well, as you can see, we're outside the home of a man described by many speedway experts as the most exciting rider in the world right now. Yes, that man is Mark Loram, and we're here in rural Suffolk to interview the man and also bring you an exciting tape detailing the highlights of his career so far. Well, Mark, let's take you way, way back to your early life and your days at school. Did you particularly enjoy them?
Probably didn't at the time, like all kids at school, you know, really found it pretty boring. But everyone says to you when you're at school, you know, you look back and they're the best days of your life, and you go, nah, load of rubbish, like. But it probably was, you know, it was good. It was good. Thinking about it, it was real good fun. It's a shame I didn't enjoy it a bit more or go a bit more often, maybe.
And what subjects did you like and which ones didn't you?
Well, I was always keen to do things with my hands, like woodwork, metalwork, you know, automobile technology, what we had then. You know, my girlfriend always laughs at me because I'm old enough to remember the 11 plus when I was doing that, and CSEs as opposed to GCSEs. So but mainly it was things to do, like I could actually put my, you know, skill in with my hands, because unfortunately, I got the concentration, you know, level of a goldfish, really. So not very not very useful when you're sitting in a class for hours on end.
And were you always interested in sports at school too?
Yeah, I mean, I always enjoyed, like, football and, you know, the usual sort of things you used to do. But again, I was a little bit of a bad attitude at school, probably. I used to sit up, sort of run around for half an hour and then think to myself, well, what am I doing here running around after a bag of wind for no reason? So I used to... never used to go down too well with my PE teacher, because he knew I used to ride at the time, junior racing. He would always, you know, shout at me for not putting the effort in and getting fit and that, you know. And I used to say to him, I've got a bike to help me around, so I don't have to be too fit.
Yeah, how did you first get involved with riding motorbikes?
Well, when I lived in Canterbury, my dad used to take me to Canterbury Speedway, and he was pretty interested in it, you know, having been in the, I suppose, from way back when he was in the army with Neil Middleditch's brother, Steve. You know, he used to take me to Canterbury, and then we, like, got mopeds, the usual sort of thing, and we used to go off trail riding together, and I'd follow him around, and progress from there, really. I mean, we did that for about 4 years, and then one day he sort of took me to a junior grass track meeting, and sort of like that following Christmas, we got a bike and that organised from Brian Foote in Canterbury, and that was it. Then I was off.
And well, he most certainly was, and we can see him riding in his grass track meetings at his early age, 9 years of age. And well, here he is at Chartham in Kent, local to him when he lived in Canterbury. And well, leading the field there. And well, now here he comes around the outside, plenty of the Laramsky style here. Even at a very tender age indeed. This also in Kent at Denton near Folkestone. And well, showing the style that was to thrill thousands later on, of course, in his career. And well, one of the people very much instrumental in getting Mark started, of course, was his father, Paul. And we did catch up with him and spoke about his early days.
With me now is Mark's father, Paul. And Paul, let's go back to the very beginning, and an unusual birthplace for a would-be speedway rider.
Yeah, Malta. I was serving in the British Army at the time, and that's where he was born, in British Military Hospital in Imtiaza in Malta. Funny thing about it was that Vi, Mark's mum's always been nervous of speed. Yeah, when she was carrying Mark, I used to hire the occasional car, and she was always wanting to go faster and drive here and drive there. And even the night I ran her up to the hospital, it was sort of a bit of a sort of a flat out job. It's probably where he gets his speed from.
Okay, then you moved back, obviously, to this country eventually. Now, tell us, how did you get Mark first involved with motorbikes?
We went out to look at a car down near Whitstable when I lived at Canterbury. And we were driving along, and I saw two people walking across a field with motorbikes in it, in leathers, and then they stopped to talk to somebody, and I sort of looked over my shoulder and thought, they're children. So we pulled into the field and had a look round, and I went up and started talking to a bloke called John Hill, who you probably know well. at the time he had two kiddies racing, Maxine and Marcus. And we got talking to him, and we already had a little moped we used to ride around on. So it started from there, really. I went into a bloke called Brian Foote's shop and bought a second-hand Suzuki, which was, you know, just sort of a cut-down homemade jobby. And rode his first meeting on that at a place called Denton. In his second meeting, he was seen by Reg Luckhurst, who told me that he's going too fast for the bike he was on because it was wobbling coming down the straights. Good sales pitch. So I bought a small bike off Reg, which was a couple of £100, and with a little Honda engine in it, a four-stroke this time. And that was it. He stayed on that until we went sort of in progressed and went a little bit higher with a bigger Luckhurst, but he always started on the little Luckhursts and junior grass track, and he was always on four-stroke engines except the very start, which was a two-stroke Suzuki.
And he immediately took to it like a duck to water, and he wore a very special pair of leathers at first, didn't he?
Yeah, we couldn't afford leathers. We paid £70 for the bike, and we couldn't afford leathers at the time, so I worked in Canterbury Prison at the time. We went into the workshops there, told the lads, and between us we knocked up a pair of plasticky type leathers, all in black, because that was the thing them days. Speedway riders used to wear a lot of black, and that was it. We made his first pair of leathers, and when they got wet, the little stripes on them were made of cloth as well, and all the dye used to run down the arms. It was quite funny, really. But 3 weeks later we picked up a cheap pair, sort of. Once we got in and got contacts, we picked another little pair up about 150. I think they cost more than the bike, actually. The first pair of leathers cost more than his first bike.
Well, a highly successful junior grass track career, but he got hooked on Speedway, he tells us, when you took him along to watch at Canterbury.
Yeah, we used to go along there. I again come back from Malta, it was, and then eventually returned to Canterbury again, and just went along, heard the Speedway bikes one night, sort of ferreted the noise out, found it, and started supporting Canterbury. And it was a progression, really, you know, from the junior grass track. Everybody used to go to the Speedway on a Saturday night. It was a meeting place, just as well as sort of watching the Speedway. And it progressed from there. He became the mascot down there and used to get a few rides during the start of the meeting, sometimes at the end, but there was so much of a problem of time and running over their time that it wasn't sort of always he got a ride at the end, but always got a ride before. In fact, I shouldn't really admit this, but one day I met a load of friends down there and I got a little bit worse for wear. And Mark, I was on my motorbike at the time, he was down there with some friends, and Mark actually drove me home on my motorbike. And it was quite strange to see people. He was waving to everybody, and of course in them days you didn't have to wear helmets on the road. And there was Mark in front, sort of me right up behind him, and he was taking me home, taking Dad home. But it's never happened since.
Well, we can see Mark there just coming into shot, as his sister Tracy there having a bit of fun and games with a friend. And there is young Mark. There is a very young Paul Lorham as well, playing up to the camera. And well, Mark may not have given Dad any more lifts on the motorbike, but he did on the go-karts, you can see. And well, there's Mum Vi, a rare family day out away from the grass track in those early days. And well, Tracy waving to the camera, and Mark showing the style once more, this time on four wheels. Now, well, it looks like Vi's going to be overtaken here, and well, now let's rejoin Mark as he talks about those early days in grass track.
We'll talk now a little bit about the junior grass track scene that you said you got involved in. And it proved to be a highly successful time for you with a couple of British championships.
Yeah, you know, my parents used to put a lot of effort in. It wasn't a cheap thing to be in, and you know, they didn't earn a lot of money, and they used to put a lot of it towards me, which obviously I'm sort of eternally grateful for. But you know, for the equipment I had, I used to do very well, and I ended up winning the British championships twice. First occasion, I think, was in the 150cc class when I was 12-ish, I don't know, but might have been a bit younger than that. And I was always there or thereabouts. Even when I didn't win it, I was well up there. But I think the first time I won was in Bristol. And the second time I actually won a national championship was when Graham Hurry sponsored me, a joint with Tig Perry, the late Tig Perry. They built me a 250 Westlake, and it was the last year I was in junior racing. I managed to win the British Championships on it. Not for the fact, again, the bike I had wasn't the quickest bike there, but the fact that I used to, you know, keep it on and wring its neck, really, and just make a lot of ground up on the other riders. But, yeah, they were enjoyable years, and I couldn't remember every meeting I'd done because I was out most weekends, but, you know, I went for a lot of years hardly dropping any races, which was quite an achievement.
And presumably in those days there were quite a few of your opponents who have become opponents on the speedway circuits in latter years.
Yeah, you know, the likes that everyone will know, obviously Stoney, Sean Wilson, Screeny, obviously, although he was always a class below me. You know, well, Sean Wilson, yes, Stoney was probably in the same class a lot of the time. Richard Musson, who sort of give out now. David Mullett, who was then a couple of classes above me, with Jamie and Jeremy Luckhurst. There's endless names of blokes that, you know, everyone would recognise through the speedway.
And whilst you were doing the junior grass track in latter years, as you say, you started practising at Highweight.
Yeah, that's it. With the sort of grass track set up, I used to go to Highweight, and then in the winter when there was no speedway on. When I got to roughly the age of sort of 14, Denzel Kent actually lent me his bike when he went home in the winter months back to South Africa. He lent me a bike to try and actually ride, you know, 500, which I thoroughly enjoyed. I mean, I wore that thing out all winter when he went home the first time, and you know, again, he was very helpful to me in the early days of my career. And you know, with Hackney on the Saturday afternoons later on, and I weighed in the early days, it was a good start for me, really.
So when did you actually decide to make Speedway a career?
Well, like kids, you know, we always want to just get straight into it. And as soon as I'm 16, you know, I was still doing my exams at school, and my dad was picking me up, taking me straight up to Sheffield, and that from a sort of first away match. And I did start in the first division, so it was pretty difficult for me. But, you know, I think from an early age, when, you know, obviously you're winning races and people are showing an interest in you, and you think you can do it, then you know, you pursue it as much as you can. But I think actual age, when I thought I was going to probably be, if you can say, good enough to ride speedway for a living, was probably when I was sort of 13 or 14.
Well, immediately, as I say, got hooked on speedway, practising at Highweight, Hackney, various other places. And then the big break when he was 16 years old and straight into the hurly-burly of the British League at Hackney.
Yeah, it was a big break too. There's no way, we put together quite a bit for him, but there's no way I could afford to get him in. So it was down to Dave Pavitt, really. Dave, I mean, without Dave, we'd have never been able to start. There's so much talent in the junior ranks on the grass track in them days, and there probably still is, and they just can't afford to go any further. I'm a great believer that promoters should be doing what football managers do, send scouts around and see if anybody's worth it. There was a lot of that at Hackney because we used to get free practice and get a bit of a discounted Highweight, and you know, they were always very good to us. People like Marvin Cox used to turn up at the house when he was sort of the name on everybody's lips. Marvin used to always turn up with a bag of sprockets or anything he was taking off his league bikes. He used to always give to Mark. And of course then, as you say, we started at Hackney, and then I think we stayed associated with Hackney and that promotion for quite a few years.
So having decided to become a professional speedway rider at 16, you were plunged straight into the hurly-burly of the British League and Hackney.
Yeah, Dave Pavitt influenced my career a lot early in the early days. He was a good friend of the family, and also a good sponsor in them days. And he then got involved in Hackney that year. And John Dewey came down to be the team manager. And although another person that influenced my career a lot in the early days was Andy Galvin's dad, Chris Galvin. He was then going into Canterbury. And it was a bit of a split decision, you know, on what to do, whether to go and ride at Canterbury and get some experience or go straight in for the big league. But that year they each team promoted a junior, or as such promoted a junior, and I figured that my job was to go out there and beat that other junior that was promoted up. And you know, Dave looked after me, and I guess I felt a certain amount of loyalty to him because he was a good friend and a good sponsor. And I decided to sort of go for the big one and go in at Hackney. And in hindsight, that worked out well, because I think I finished on about just over 5 point average, which, you know, for my first year was brilliant, you know, and I did enjoy it, and I don't regret going straight in on the big, you know, first division.
Yeah, I mean, a lot, as you said, you had a chance of going in the National League, as I think it was called then, and you spurned that. A lot of riders haven't done, but you're one of the few exceptions.
Yeah, that's it. It's not easy, but like I say, that particular year, that each team had to have like a new junior or a young rider. I can't remember what the rules stated, but you know, so my job was to go in and beat the other rider, and I think 9 times out of 10 I'd probably done my job, which was what I was there to do. And had a very successful and you know, good first year, really, considering that was the first division. And I was 16, and bear in mind, when I was 16 I was probably, you know, a good foot shorter and about 6 stone lighter than I am now, so it wasn't easy. I was getting knocked about a bit, but I stuck in there, and that was good.
And well, it certainly was good for Mark. We can take a look at some footage now from him in 1987, this at Wimbledon. Plough Lane, of course, sadly lost to Speedway these days, and well, he's in the white helmet colour here, and well, he leads the way together with his teammate Roland Dano and Terry Musset and Nathan Simpson are the two Wimbledon Dons. But it is all Hackney at the moment. They scored a 5-1 in the first race. Our thanks to Race Video for this footage. And well, of course, local derbies between these two sides always were fiercely contested affairs. Roland Dano, of course, whose career was so tragically cut short. He's in second place. Mark it is, though, who leads the way, certainly doing his job defeating the opposing junior in this one. Nathan Simpson in third place. But Mark it is who wins the race, much to the delight of the Hackney Kestrels fans. Oh, well, it was a great night for the EastEnders as they came away with a 44-34 victory. And well, there is Mark on top of the tractor there, together with Simon Wigg, his captain, as Paul Whittaker goes over to draw the raffle. A famous victory at Plough Lane. Oh, well, it certainly was a good year for Mark, this before the Hackney v Oxford British League match, October 28th, right near the end of the season. And well, there is the then world champion Hans Nielsen presenting Mark with the Young Rider of the Year award. You may just have got a glimpse of Alfie Whedon there. The veteran snapper, of course, taking the pictures. It really was an excellent first year for Mark. Hans just having a little chat with him. And with a very young Brilliant Williams also there, as you can see, on the centre green presenter. And well, we can see the style around Walterton Road now, this heat number 2. And Mark, well, he's made the start. Nicker Gate in those days, and teaming up with Barry Thomas against Ali Stevens and John Sermon. Ali has come through into second place. Tom, of course, at veteran stage of his career now, but well, showing that famous style of his. And Mark, full throttle, as you can see there, into the first and second bend, as Tomo really still gives chase on young Ali Stevens. Well, he certainly does look about a foot shorter than what he is these days. as he wins race number two from Stevens, just holding Tomo at bay. Now, well, now we see Mark again in action. This a couple of races later, and he's out with his captain Simon Wigg against Marvin Cox and Ali Stevens. Oxford, of course, where they were crowned British League champions this season. As the race, well, it gets underway, and Wigg it is who leads, but look who's come through in a second place. Yes, it is Mark ahead of Marvin Cox, who was a heat leader at this stage of his career. And Ali Stevens, well, he's at the back, and now Mark, well, he's come around the outside as Simon Wigg is helping to protect the youngster. Hackney, well, they did struggle a little bit in the league in 1987, but well, this was a famous victory for them. And our thanks once again to Race Video for this footage. As Mark, well, he comes around to win his second race in a row. He did finish off the season extremely well at Walterton Road, as the Kestrels, well, they went on to a 2-point victory over the league champions. Now, well, here comes the team: Simon Wigg, Mark, Lauren, Barry Thomas, Andy Garen, Alan Johansson and Rowan Dano. And well, did you spot what Mark did then? Now let's rejoin him with Bryn.
Well, your first season, 1987 in the British League, but then Hackney themselves made the decision to drop down to the National League the following season, and you stayed there, and what a season it turned out to be.
Yeah, it's quite a funny story really, because, you know, the year before Hackney were in the first division, Simon Wigg was there, and, you know, and Dave, bless him, he was a big influence on me when I was younger, and I was obviously easily persuaded or gullible, and he sort of said, yeah, first division 87, you'll be all right, and sure enough, when the club dropped down to the second division, it was, oh, you want another year, and you want to try a year in second division, I'll do your confidence the world of good. So sure enough, I went second division, which again, I don't regret it. It was a good year for me. I was sponsored still on the Westlakes that year, and you know, ended up, I think, over a 10-point average, winning the under 21 championships and a number of other meetings, and just generally riding and not really caring much and enjoying life, you know, which is what I used to do. Was just, I never used to really think about getting on the bike much, and used to wash it now and again and get on it and ride. It was a very enjoyable year.
Yeah, I mean, it was a fabulous year and a fabulous team at Hackney. Andy Galvin, yourself, Chris Louie, Barry Thomas, and well, the whole team just gelled together from start to finish, didn't it?
Yeah, we had a great thing. I mean, obviously grew up with Andy. Yeah, and the likes of Mogo and everyone, and Barry Thomas taught me a lot when I was at Sittingbourne or Highway. You know, there's so many people, and as you go on, you know, you don't forget to sort of like mention them, but Chris Louie, I mean, grew up with him in junior grass track, you know, become very good friends. You know, we're the best of mates. And that year, Chris done a little bit of coming to a few of the meetings with me, you know, and sort of see how I was getting on, and got to meet up with him a bit more, and I think he got keen as well. So it was very enjoyable. You know, you sort of tend to forget, but although times have changed, you never forget, you know, what fun you had and how laid back and, well, young at the time, and you got nothing to worry about.
I mean, all conquering Hackney side in 1998, and yourself and Andy Galvin, you more or less dominated all the individual meetings that you entered.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, I think Hackney that year had a fair old roll of honour, really. You know, we pretty much wiped the board of everything between, like you say, me and Andy, and we couldn't ask for any more. Really, that was the year when, you know, I think I won quite a few awards, a Swapper Award, and a few other things that year, if I remember. It's just terrible. I've got such a bad memory, I can never remember it all. But it was a good season.
Yeah, I suppose the one disappointment that I seem to remember is that you broke your collarbone or your shoulder just before the 14 tournament finals.
Yeah, that's right. I think, yeah, that was actually, I broke my wrist, broke a scaphoid at Hackney. I remember that. And I remember being at the four-team tournament finals, obviously couldn't go, you know, arm in plaster and that, but, you know, relatively injury-free up till then, so can't complain, really.
As I say, a marvellous season of league and cup double, and beating Wimbledon in the cup final. The atmosphere at both stadiums was electric on those nights.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, it's hard. Like, it's unbelievable the fact that there's no London clubs now, but apart from Arena Essex, but that's not quite London. But yeah, I mean, you can imagine the atmosphere was good. You know, being in Wimbledon and Hackney, local derby, really. There was, you know, like the old Wolves Cradley situation, it was good, and it's just a shame now that you know, a fair bit of that's gone.
Well, we'll take a look at some of the action from 1988, and where you can see Mark coming out. This is the National League match against Wimbledon in September. Mark is in red, in blue it is Paul Whitaker, in white we got Nathan Simpson, in yellow and black it is Todd Wiltshire. What a great first season Todd had in this country. He's back in third place at the moment. It is Mark who leads the way. And Hackney, well, if they win this match here this evening, they will be crowned the National League champions. As Paul Whitaker, well, he's come through there, as you can see on the inside of Todd. But Wiltshire, well, he's fought back himself on the inside and regains third place. Meanwhile, out in front, Mark Lauren, well, he still leads the way from Nathan Simpson in second place. And Whitaker, again, he attempts to come past the Aussie, and he's done so once more. Can Wiltshire answer him once again as they come around to start the final lap? It looks as if he has. Meanwhile, Mark Lorimer is in, who still leads the way. Paul Whitaker, well, he's come back past once more into third place. So it looks like the Ramsey is going to get the victory. He does indeed. Second place goes to Nathan Simpson. Third spot to Paul Whitaker. Hackney, well, they lead him by 4 points to two before that race, by 10 points to 2 before that race. That 4-2 moves them into a 14-4 lead. Well, by the time it came to heat number 9, Hackney were leading by 37 points to 11. Mark and Paul, they'd had a 5-1 in their second outing together. Watch what happens in this one, as the rider in white, that is Ray Moulton, leads the way from Whitaker in second place. Mark, well, he's fighting with Andy Campbell for third place, and he comes through there on the inside. Famous Walterton Road Circuit, of course, one of the best in the land. And we're now watch for Mark as he tries to come around the outside of his teammate, but, well, they get it wrong between the pair of them, and, well, he comes down, quite a heavy spill for the young 17-year-old, and he was excluded from the rerun. And, well, now we can see Mark in his next ride, this heat number 13, and the Kestrels, well, they only need a couple of points to be crowned the National League champions for 1988. Todd Wiltshire leads the way, but you can see Mark in second place. Alan Mogridge is back in third, and, well, that's good enough for the EastEnders to take the title. There is Bryn, John Lewis, and also Gary Muckley, part of the consortium back in 1988. And, well, the Queen record, we are the champions, now can be played. As Mark heads straight back to the pits, but Hackney, well, they'd won their first league title for many, many seasons. And the celebrations, they could begin. And, well, as you can see, a very big crowd indeed turn up to salute the league champions. Andy Galvin, Chris Louie, Alan Mogridge, Paul Whitaker, Mark Lorham, Gary Rolls, and also Barry Thomas, of course, going around on the parade vehicle. And, well, you can see the celebrations beginning in earnest. Andy Galvin there opening the champagne, Tomo drinking it, that seems about right. And, well, there you can see young Mark on the left, spraying all and sundry, including Uncle Elf Whedon and his captain as well. And, well, that was the first part of a possible double, of course, and it was a small case of the knockout cup final against Wimbledon. And, well, the first leg was at Hackney. We'll take a look at heat number 4. The HO1 Kestrels leading by 14 points to 4, and we can see Mark leading the way. Watch here for Barry Thomas as he comes around the outside of Ray Moulton into second place. Rodney Payne Well, he is in last position, but it is young Mark that leads, and he's looking for his veteran teammate, Tomo. Well, he's always been great, a team rider, and Mark, well, he's starting to develop into a fine team rider as well here, as they are keeping Ray Moulton behind him. Mark allows Tomo through into first place, and there's going to be no way past for Rip Snorting Ray Moulton, and as he was known in his early years. A lap to go, and Tomo it is who leads the way, and Hackney, well, they're going to open up a 14 point lead after just four races. They're blitzing the Wimbledon Montine Dons early on as they take the chequered flag. Tomo wins it from Mark, third spot to Ray Moulton. Rodney Payne at the back. Well, Hackney went on to win that first leg by 60 points to 36. Now let's take a look at some action from the second leg, this heat 9.
Right, it's going to be a close call into the first turn. And it's Wiltshire and Laran. Wiltshire's away. Laran is going hard under him. Wiltshire pulling back as they go into the top corner. Shoulder to shoulder. Wiltshire's in front. Second place is Laran. Laran coming through on the inside. Third place is Andy Campbell. And a real battle on now as Mark Laran switches back under Todd Wiltshire. He leads it. Second place Wiltshire. Third is Campbell. Wiltshire's in terrible trouble on the indicator board corner. Still Laram in front, getting a bit tight for the oppositions, and Barry Thomas hasn't finished trying either. Wiltshire is second, Campbell is third. Over the line it's going to be Mark Laram. Second place is Wiltshire, third is Andy Campbell.
And Hackney, well, they did go on to a 50 points to 46 victory at Wimbledon, and they won the knockout cup by a massive 110 points to 82 on aggregate, the double champions for 1988. And the celebrations only just starting at Plough Lane. And well, it wasn't just at club level that Mark gained recognition in 1988. He was selected for international action, National League Select for Sweden. And we joined the match at Mildenhall, the second test. Heat number 17, Mark, well, he's out with his clubmate Andy Galvin against Roland Dano and Peter Narlene. And it is Roland who leads the way. Former teammate, of course, of Mark the previous year in the old British League. And well, he's in first place, Peter Narlene in second. Mark, well, he knows he must try and find a way past, or else Sweden are going to move into a three-point lead with just one race remaining. Peter Narlene in second spot. Roland Dano it is who leads the way. But just 17 years of age at this stage of his career, a lap to go, and well, he really is having a terrific scrap there with Peter, who went on to a very successful British League career, of course. And as they come round to take the chequered flag, Roland Dano's going to get the win. But watch here as Mark, as he makes a last desperate attempt, and well, he just gets up into second place. A marvellous ride there by the youngster. But in the end, it worked to no avail for the National League Select as they went down in a last heat decider. But a great ride by Mark Loram. We're now the following night, and we'll look at the two teams once more in action. This is the third test down at Exeter, and this heat number one. And we see when Mark, well, he's made a very fast start indeed from Andy Galvin in second place, coming past Krister Karlsson with Jimmy Nielsen, the Swedish number one. He's at the back as Mark leads the way. One of his first ever visits, of course, to the vast county ground circuit, and we're obviously taking a liking to it. One of the tracks, of course, that he was to join later on in his British League career. A couple of laps gone, and he leads from his club captain, Andy Galvin, in second place. with Krista Coulson in third. Jimmy Nielsen, well, he's still at the back. Mark Willey went on to have a good meeting this night, but the National League select, again, they went down to a narrow defeat in a last heat decider, going down by just 3 points, but Mark was showing his pedigree here, coming round to win the opening race at the county ground. And for our last bit of action from 1988, we'll take a look at Mark on the individual front. This is the Brett Alderton Memorial Meeting at Milton Keynes, and this is the restart of heat number two. Troy Butler fell and was excluded the first running of it, and we can see Mark out in front ahead of Eastbourne legend Gordon Kennett, former world number two, with Ian Barney from Peterborough back in third place. And we can see track conditions far from ideal, almost two-wheeling it around the bends. And well, the young Mark, he certainly wasn't afraid of being a bit controversial as he won the race and well, then was presented with his prize on the centre green. And we spoke to Mike Bennett, and this is what he had to say to Mike and the crowd.
Well, first of all, congratulations on your performance at Eastbourne in the World Championship. A little bit tricky conditions tonight, though.
Yeah, the track's got a right hand to go on it, the wall was too much.
Not mincing his words off track, and well, on track he was in absolutely unbeatable form. Here he is in heat number 18. He won his next three races, and well, the opposition nowhere in sight. He's going to come round and get a 15 point maximum, a faultless meeting for him here at the Groveway. Sadly no longer racing, of course, at this circuit, but Mark Loram crowned the Brett Alderton Memorial Champion for 1988. The individual success starting to come Mark's way. And well, climbing on top of the rostrum, steady on there, climbing on top of the rostrum, which is something that he's done many times throughout his career there, accepting the shield from Trevor Banks, winning it ahead of Nigel Diath and the late Nigel Sparshot.
Well, the end of a highly successful 1988 season with Hackney, and then came your first trip abroad, a trip to South Africa, and he was only 17 at the time when you went out there, and you had to miss the first couple of meetings.
Yeah, that's it. It was funny, really, because Peter Murray, the guy that organised the tour, you know, he wanted me to go over, and I wasn't old enough to ride, because in them days you weren't allowed to ride abroad until you're 18. So yeah, it was good, you know. I got out there, had to miss the first one or two meetings because I wasn't old enough, and but again, it was like Andy, me and Chris and Rob Tilbury and all the boys and Steve. You know, I can tell you some stories, make your hair curl. It was really good. And it was my first trip abroad, and I was, you know, green and up for it. And it was very enjoyable. It was thoroughly good.
Yeah, some great racing, particularly at Corabrick.
Yeah, that's it. You know, it was a little track and sort of similar size to the one in America, Costa Mesa, so the racing was always close, and there wasn't a lot of difference between the bloke in first place and the bloke in fourth, so very entertaining, put on a good show for the people that were there. And of course you had the added bonus of you was in a beautiful country, people looking after you, and just generally having a good time.
Yeah, good time off track, and including your 18th birthday party. Do you remember much about that?
Yeah, I can. I actually watched the video the other night for the first time in years, you know, and it's funny to see. Yeah, it was the boys stitched me up a treat there, you know, but of course you have to go through with it, you know. It was really funny.
And as well as the birthday party itself, plenty of time spent by the pool and jet skiing and stuff like that.
Yeah, that's it. Plenty of time rectifying mistakes and, you know, paying the hotel for damage and things. All harmless things, really.
Yeah, a little bit of a problem with the bubble bath.
Yeah, that's it. We never done anything, you know, bad or anything. It was just all things that, you know, got a little bit out of hand, but it was good, harmless fun, really, and we always put anything right, so it wasn't too bad.
So your first trip abroad really was hard work, yeah?
Yeah, it was hard work. It was well, it's definitely hard on the old liver anyway. It was good, you know. We enjoyed it.
And well, we certainly did. Aaron, looks like this four-legged friend is enjoying the ride from Mark as well. Another passenger for him to take home. This South African rider nodding O'Dea's house in Johannesburg. And well, there is Richard Knight, former Kingsland and England rider, of course, filming us, filming him. And well, one day the riders decided to wear Speedway boots down to breakfast. That certainly caused a bit of a stir. And well, the gang are there, Rob Tilbury, Neville Tatum in the background. There is Chris. There is Mark, being the youngest. He got picked on once or twice.
I was trying to ride.
And well, it's cooled him down somewhat. And well, here comes Andy, his captain and mentor, looking after him.
Save him!
Ah, well, didn't do a very good job there, did he?
Oh, what?
Oh, well, now we see Mark in action in the swimming pool under his own steam. Well, that weren't too bad.
That did hurt.
And we now see Mark in tandem with Rob Tilbury. Kelly Moran, left-hand side of your picture. And, well, acrobatics in the pool, as you can see. And well, Bryn spoke about the famous bubble bath incident. And we'll just take a look at this.
Shampoo gun. Ready?
Coming.
This is called the shampoo gun. You must
Oh, that's
Shampoo. That was
Uncle Steven.
This is the loo.
It's not toilets there. Hold on. Yeah. Come in the toilet.
There's one thing wrong with you two old boys.
There's a sink.
You ain't
think?
Right in the head.
We're right in the head.
It's called bubble mania,
isn't it?
Look. Just sit on the floor, Steve.
You're steaming up,
Paul.
Well, there's our main man.
Hold on, come here.
That's better.
You heard, Steve?
That's better.
Put it out to
me. Well, as you can see, things getting totally out of hand. That's Chris.
Where's Andy?
We'll think about that.
And well, Andy's down there somewhere. And well, believe us, things did get cleared up eventually, and no damage was done. But now let's go to Mark's 18th birthday party at the clubhouse at the Coralbrick Speedway track.
That's the way you're going to have to do it. Hey, hold out.
Oh. Well, as you can see, everyone enjoying themselves in the clubhouse. And well, here it is. And well, that's a shame. And well, now we'll take a look at Mark on track, his first ever meeting in South Africa. And well, he's out against Rob Tilbury, Grant Foley and Des Jones, a couple of South African riders. And well, you can see him come around the former Canterbury and Arena Essex star to lead the way. And we're racing at this tiny Coralbrick Raceway just outside Johannesburg, and Mark adapting very well indeed to it. Similar in size to the Costa Mesa Raceway in California. And Mark will look behind, but no danger to his lead. And winning this one pretty comfortably ahead of Turbo Tilbury, with Des Jones coming through into third ahead of Grant Foley. So racing South African style. And now for contrast, we go down to Durban to the Natal Open Championship, and Mark Willey's out against his great friend Denzel Kent, who helped him out greatly in his early days in grass track when he first started on speedway circuits, of course. And well, Mark, he's well on his way to victory in this one. And well, I'm sure you've enjoyed this little trip down memory lane as much as Mark will, as he takes, we take a look back at his early years on the international scene. Now let's go and rejoin him talking about the 1989 season.
Well, after the end of that marvellous 1988 season at Hackney, it was perhaps inevitable that under the points limit the team had to be broken up. But Dave Pavitt found a unique way of getting around that, because he bought into Ipswich, and yourself, Chris Louie and Alan Mogridge moved up to Foxhall Heath to form the basis of the side.
Yeah, that's it. I can't remember an awful lot about 89, but I know I was on Goddens that year, and yeah, we all moved up to Ipswich, you know, as a new base and a new start for me, really, because obviously in the end I ended up living in the area. So it was a good year again. Me and Chris spent a lot of time together. I stayed at John Lewis quite a lot in the end of the year. So it was enjoyable when Chris started riding, because me and him spend a lot of time together. So although, like I say, I can't remember an awful lot about the year, to be honest.
Yeah, I seem to remember you had a couple of crazy Australians in the side, as well as you three Englishmen.
Yeah, I mean, Craig Hyde and Steve Witt. Steve Witt actually lives in the same village up the road, and is still now married an English girl. Craig Hyde I see in Australia, probably 6 years back. Still as mad as ever, you know, he's crazy. Good bloke, though.
Yeah, so fourth in the league, perhaps not as successful, well, obviously not as successful as the previous year at Hackney, but at least Ipswich Speedway was back on the map.
Yeah, that's it. It was back on the map under the banner of Dave and John Lewis and Mike Weston. And it was something different, something new for Ipswich, having been in the British League so long, dropped in the National League. So it was a shame the team had to split up at Hackney, but I suppose, like you say, it was the best way of doing it.
Well, now let's take a look at him in action in 1989. This is the local derby against Peterborough. Mark in the red helmet colour.
Chance he may get in that World Under 21 final. Fingers crossed for him. Hopefully he can make it. One man who is in it is Mark Lauren, and he's in heat four, and he's just pipped to the first turn by Kevin Jolly. Bobby Fuller's on the inside, but Lauren came around the outside of his partner, and now trying to challenge Jolly on the inside, and Lauren coming herring through into the third turn. It's Mark Lauren leading. He's come from third to first in half a straight. Kevin Jolly tucked in his second, Robbie Fuller in third, and Justin Walker at the back.
Yeah, well, Mark went on to win this race. Now let's take a look at him in his next ride.
Now,
with this, the rerun, Scott Norman having been excluded.
He makes another good start, though, just tipping Mark Lauren to that first bend. It's Hodgson leading, the Australian, Mark Lauren in second, and Robbie Fuller in third. Here comes Lauren, though, trying to drive round the outside of Hodgson, coming out of the fourth bend. And Lauren then, coming past the young Australian, it's Mark Lauren leading now. Another pass from the back from the exciting Lauren.
And well, it was another great piece overtaking manoeuvre by Mark. And we'll now let's see him in his next race against the Peterborough number one, Mick Paul.
We've won two of the major honours this season. Mark Lauren in red, Robbie Fuller blue. That's Mick Paul in white, his second ride on the trot. And Ian Barney in yellow and black. So just 2 points behind now. Thanks to that 5-1 in heat 10. And the Witches hit back in heat 11. And Mick Paul making a good start there, leading to the first turn, and Ian Barney on the inside. So Lauren relegated to third, for the minute at least. Lauren coming on the outside of Ian Barney, and now sets off in hot pursuit of Mick Paul. So it's Mickey Paul leading, Lauren in second, and Barney third. Lauren now switching to the inside, in a bit to close the ground on Mick Paul. Mick Paul just having a quick glance over his shoulder, and you'll see that Mark Lauren is right there. by Mighty Mick, as his band of fans at Peterborough call him. He's got a race in his hands at the moment against Mighty Mark. So which one has the strongest might? Certainly Paul has the upper hand at the moment. We're on back into second. But last season, I remember, it was a crash between these two that sidelined Lorham for over a month. In Lorham's Hackney days, of course. But he's back at the moment, and he just pushes Paul all the way, and Mickey Paul just hanging on there.
And well, indeed, Mick did, but a terrific race between these two riders. And, well, Ipswich did go on to a narrow victory over their big rivals at the time. Now let's take a look at Mark on his travels.
From the inside, it's cool.
Well, we can see Mark now racing at the now sadly defunct Powder Hall Circuit against Edinburgh. He just smashed the Trek record in his first ride. What can he do in his second?
If he can get out in front, Les would no doubt be interested in getting back the Trek record, which he formerly had a share of, but Mark Lorham's comfortably beaten him out at the start there as Les lifted. Too many of the Edinburgh riders are leaping into the air from the start. Les is on Lorham's tail now, though. Can he make any ground on the National League Riders' Champion? So far, he's not doing it. We're not getting much passing tonight. Track's so fast that nobody's making any mistakes, and not the usual brand of Powder Hall overtaking.
And well, Mark certainly was fast in this one. He smashed his own track record once again, a marvellous effort. His first ever visit to this circuit. And Ipswich, where he went on to an away victory. Mark's scoring paid 14. Excellent effort by the youngster. And we'll now take a look at him in international duty in 89.
But he's really flying now, and that was a magnificent victory there. And I'm sure the time for that race won't be far away from the track record either.
Number 13.
And well, we see Mark riding for the National League side against Australia. And we'll just look at that score after 12 heats this at his home Foxhall Heath track.
They have got the two outstanding riders in the National League from last year in this one. We're looking there at Steve Regling, the skipper of the Australians, who has a couple of second places, but has hardly been the dominant force that manager James Easter was anticipating. Mark Loram is in red. He hasn't been beaten by an Aussie yet. Two wins and a second place behind his partner, Steve Schofield. The number one and two in National League averages in 1988. And if they can gain anything from Heat 13, then the National League select will be home and dry. Here's Heat 13. Craig Boyce, the rider in yellow on the outside. And it is a real piece of cornering there. Loram did well to hold on as Boyce made his move down the middle of Loram and Schofield. It's a bit sticky out there. It has been raining. It's going to be terribly icy and dicey on the inside. You have to ride sort of middle and out. It has unfortunately got just a little bit processional. A very heavy shower, and this track has been badly affected by rain. Normally, of course, Foxhall Heath, a tremendous racing track. It has to be said today, we've had a lot of rain earlier, which made it just a little bit of a sticky dog in places, and it has affected racing. As you can see here, it's processional, and that's a pity really, because certainly the first test at Wimbledon was a real cracker, with hard first corners and riders being spread eagle and a last heat decider, and very little processions. But Mark Loram is a mile in front here in 13.
And so Mark going on to a very easy victory indeed, as described by Dave Lanning, and the National League select went on to a 60 points to 36 victory. And after this race, they had a few words with Mark.
Mark, you just got time to get your breath back. Well done, unbeaten by an Australian all afternoon. What was the track like after that shower?
It's kind of greasy on the bit where everyone's been riding, so you've got to ride it careful, sort of not a lot of motor and drift across the skinny bit and get into the bit that holds you up, you know, so it is a bit dodgy, but you got to watch it.
Yeah, but you've done it, you've won it quite comfortably, the event here, put you level in the series.
That's right, yeah, I mean, we're all fired up today, and especially myself, because first meeting back since injury, so, you know, I think we've just got to hang in there at Paul and at Hackney, and we'll be well away.
Well, although it wasn't particularly successful for Ipswich, finishing fourth in the league in 1989, the season ended in a fabulous way for you because you became National League Riders Champion.
Yeah, like I say, I couldn't remember an awful lot about that year, but obviously it was a highlight for me that year, winning the National League Riders Championship. I think the year before I only finished second or third, I can't quite remember, but yeah, it was a good meeting to win, probably the biggest meeting of the year in the National League, and although my average took a little bit of a drop from the year before, you know, that was a good thing that I won it, sort of made up for that a little bit, really.
Yeah, a real highlight then, and but possibly one of the nastiest moments you had in 1989 was the 16 lapper at Foxhall. You were leading right up to the very last bend, and then disaster struck.
Yeah, it's always been a meeting I've done and enjoyed, but it's always eluded me. I've always been winning it or thereabouts, and like you say, that particular year I was leading it till the very last corner, and forks broke going into the corner. I ended up in an untidy mess. Luckily, I was okay, but again, didn't win the 16 lapper title, and I think I've finished on the rostrum in it probably about four times about, and never actually managed to win it, so maybe next year.
We're at the top pair.
Now, well, we'll take a look at some of that action. Firstly, from the 16 lap classic, and it really was the most instant packed meeting and resulted in a two-man runoff for the title over four laps, and it was against Mark and his great friend and rival, his teammate from last year and captain Andy Galvin. This is the runoff.
Certainly in the National League. So here we go then, the runoff, and Galvin moving, and he's missed the start, and that could be crucial. This is just over four laps, it might be worth mentioning, and Mark Lorham has sped into the lead. Andy Galvin messing up the start there, and that could prove very costly for the Hackney captain. So Lorham leading the way, Galvin in second. And what a tense match race now. Alan Mogridge, who's out of course, was very unlucky. Galvin's unfortunate, who was about to lead the final running, and now he's got a challenge in a runoff, and he could see it slip away. Lorham will try everything he can to hold off Andy Galvin. He's well aware of Galvin's capabilities from the back. What can Lorham do? The track is ultra slick now, and to catch Mark Lorham round here, Andy Galvin is going to have to pull something very special out of the bag indeed. Mark Lorham is hard enough to catch at the best of times, let alone on an ultra slick home track. So Lorham speeding away to victory now on the last lap. This is Galvin's last chance on the third and fourth turn as Lorham comes in. He's in trouble there and he's down. Mark Lorham has crashed out.
And well, what a sad finish for Mark. I don't think he's ever going to come any closer to winning the 16 lap classic without actually doing so. The Falks having gone. And we're now on to the National League Riders final at Coventry. Mark, where he scored 8 points from his first three rides. Here he is out in heat number 14. Our thanks to MBI Videos for this footage.
Watch out too for Mark Lorham. He's been popping up the starts tonight. Rick Hartel saying very much a danger man here. Rod Hunter could be a spoiler, although really Rod has not looked in it at all tonight. So it's another good start for Mark Lorham, although he's not that well clear. Rick Hartel in second place, and in third is Rod Hunter. But Mark Lorham, well, he's already probably thinking about getting that trophy engraved. He really is in flying form. And what is good is to see one of the young up-and-coming riders in with a chance of taking this. Last year's winner, Troy Butler, of course. He was a little bit fortunate, I'm sure he'll admit, by his own standards. But nonetheless, he reached the world final this year. And if Mark Lorham could follow in his footsteps, then I'm sure he wouldn't be complaining at all. So Lorham in front, Ricard Halsain in second place. Nigel Crabtree has moved into third now. But it's Mark Lorham who's got a bit of a weight. He's not out again. And so heat number 20. So really has got a bit of waiting. And it's just going to be a long, nervous time for him as well. But Lorham takes the 3 points. Two for Ricard Halsain and one for Nigel Crabtree.
So indeed, Mark having a long wait before seeing whether he could lift this title. Let's take a look at heat 20.
So we try again, and the atmosphere really electric this time as we go for heat number 20, the one that Mark Lorham and David Blackburn, really the pair of them, have got to take the honours here. And whoever wins it could end up as the National League Riders Champion. And this time, no problems for the starting gate. We'll look to Lorham, we'll look also to Blackburn. And there you are, it is the hunting hire, which is rider number one, Mark Lauren, who is clear with David Blackburn in second place. Just look at this now. Steve Schofield comes into the picture. Lee Adams, sadly, is out of it again with machine trouble. It's a night I'm sure he'll forget. Steve Schofield, this really is doing Kenny McKenna a lot of favours, because this will give McKenna second place in the meeting outright. Should David Blackburn manage to get past, there not be a runoff for second place. But it's all about the winner at the moment. And that looks as if it's going to go to Mark Lauren. And surely now, after this, the boy is going to have to move up and take his chances in British League racing in 1990. And you can hear that the Coventry crowd really have got behind this young man. And there you are, the National League Riders' Champion of 1989 from the Hunting Hire Witches of Ipswich, and young England's superstar of the future, perhaps, is Mark Lauren. And for tonight at least, he is no doubt going to feel on top of the world. Second place there going to Steve Schofield, and a third to David Blackburn. And of course, by tradition, Mark Lauren will have the reception down there at the pit gate, and no doubt he will be meeting the night air.
So Mark going up then to receive the trophy. Now, a very psychedelic graphic display by MBI Videos. And he receives the shield and the trophy and the champagne. And just after the meeting, Mike spoke with him.
Catted to you in the pitch. You reckon it was just about making the start, so it was a little bit more difficult than that.
That's right, yeah. I mean, the last one, there's a lot of pressure on me because the starts wouldn't work and that. You know, everything was good. Bart was good. You know, pit crew, they all helped me out. John, Chris Lee, they was all big help. And it all came together on the night, and I was the lucky one.
It's been a fantastic reaction from all of the crowd, not just the Ipswich fans. Everybody seemed to get behind you in those last couple of rides.
Yeah, I like to think, you know, majority of the crowd's behind me, whether they're not from Ipswich or whatever, but you know, I'm pleased. They all seem real good. You know, there was none really not happy with me winning, you know, so I'd just like to, you know, just thank them all, because they've all been so good.
Now, almost by tradition, the winner of the National League Riders Championship makes a move into British League racing. Last year's winner, of course, made it to this year's world final.
That's right, yeah. I'd be well happy if I did what Troy did. I mean, he's done so well this year, and I can say, you know, I really do think I should go in British League, although there won't be as many meetings. You know, I probably will make the move, and we just have to wait and see.
Well, after two successful years in the National League, you then at the end of 89 made the big decision to step up to top flight racing and move just up the road from Ipswich to King's Lynn.
Yeah, Bill Barker was running King's Lynn at the time, and I had a sponsor there, Peter Thurlow from Abbeygate Group, and they were keen to get me there, and between them they managed to sort of deal out with Dave Pavitt, and they actually bought my contract for 1990, and I started on it at King's Lynn from there.
Yeah, you spent, what, 4 or 5 years at King's Lynn, and in 1992 you came oh so close to winning the World Under-21 Championship.
Yeah, probably the worst second place in my career in Pfaffenhoff and in Germany. You know, it was a wet meeting, and I was equally, you know, going as well as Lee Adams, and we both actually had a runoff, and I probably lost the runoff by no more than half a bike, you know, through my own fault really, just missed the start, and you know, once he got in front, I couldn't get past him. But unfortunately, that year, Sunbright or Coal Light British Fuels were sponsoring Speedway that year, and
there was actually a £10,000 bonus for an under 21 world champion, and an extra bonus if somebody, an Englishman, won the world championship as well. And of course, Pavi went on to win it, so yeah, we both would have netted probably £20,000 bonus that year, but unfortunately I got not a penny, and Javi still ended up with his 10,000, I think. So that was probably the worst nightmare of my career so far, really, losing that race.
Mark Loren, well, he's getting ready for his next ride. He comes out in yellow and black. Of course, he had a second place two lead in heat number three. And there is Mark's father, Paul Loren. He's also made the journey out here to cheer on his son. To replace the reserve.
And well, let's take a look at his son in heat number 11. This is the restart of it. Mark, having scored 5 points from his first two rides, defeated by Lee Adams, first time out.
Green lights on. Are they going to get a clean start this time? Well, yes, they do. Golub gets some lift, and it is David Nice that's leading the way. Here comes Thomas Golub, though, up the inside. Mark Loren back in third place. So he's coming around the outside of Golub, through in a second now. Rennie Madsen, he's at the back. David Nice has got a little bit wide. Here comes Mark Loren up the inside, and he's moved through into the lead. So Loren, he's gone from third to first place in the matter of half a lap. David Norris now.
A brilliant ride there by Mark, and going on to his second victory, 8 points after three rides, getting the better of David Norris and a certain Thomas Golub. And well, Mark won his next race. Now let's go on to heat number 18.
Joe Screen in blue, Lars Gunnarstad in white, and Kim Brandt in yellow and black. Well, you can forget about Brandt, he won't be featuring in this race, I wouldn't imagine. Gunnarstad, he's had three race wins. So has Mark Loren, so has Joe Screen. The difference being Gunnarstad has also had a last, but Joe and Mark have had two second places as well. And the, well, one of those two should win this race. They could possibly be in a runoff with Mark Loren, with Lee Adams, should he win heat 20. A lot going for heat number 18. They get underway, and it is West Lars Gunnarstad that's leading the way. Mark Loren's in second place. Joe Screen, he finds himself at the back of behind Kim Brandt. So it's not really going to script at the moment. Gunnarstad leading the way. Joe Screen's only back in third place. Mark Loren in second. And the two English riders, well, one of them must find a way past if they're going to challenge Lee Adams, should he win heat number 20. And here comes Mark Loren trying to put Gunnarstad under some pressure as they come towards the end of lap number two. Gunnarstad out in front. Mark Loren trying to close in. Joe Screen not far behind Loren also. So Gunnarstad, can he hold on? Here comes Mark Loren up the inside. He's trying to move through. There's a bit of argy-bargy going down the back straight as they go through into the third turn. And it's Mark Loren that's come through into the lead. Lars Gunnarstad has been forced wide. And he's fighting back again now on the inside. A lap to go. Can Loren hold on? This will give him 14 points. Lars Gunnarstad, well, he's gone wide on that first and second turn. And Joe Screen's come through in the second place. A great race this one in heat number 18. But it's going to be Mark Loren that wins it. Surely Joe Screen cannot close in. Mark Loren looks over his shoulder, sees there's no problems. He's got scores 14 points. Joe Screen finishes on 13. Lars Gunnarstad on 10.
Well, what a fantastic speedway race that was. The commentator was going to be excited. And well, Lee did come out and win heat number 20, so they both finished on 14 points. Joe Screen behind them in third. This the runoff for the title.
Lee Adams for the world under 21 title. And the start, well, it could be all important. The start marshal walks away, the green light's on. Away they go, and Lee Adams has made a good start from the outside, and he's leading the way. Mark Loren back in second place, so it's Adams that's got the drop on Loren, and he's leading the way down the back straight, and he's opened up quite a lead as they go into the third turn. Can Loren possibly fight back? He's got a lot to go for, of course, but at the end of the first lap, it is Lee Adams that leads from Mark Loren. Loren certainly is closing in on the bends. Here he comes around the outside maybe of Adams, but Adams is drawing away again down the back straight. So Adams, well, is he going to spoil the party for Mark Loren? Lee, well, he really has been gating extremely well here this afternoon. And Loren, well, he's dropping back as they come into the third lap. Adams is leading the way, but Loren again, well, he's trying to close in. He's got just over a lap in which to do so. The yellow flag is out.
Lee Adams, though, is he going to be crowned the world under 21 champion, or can Lauren pull out something big on the third and fourth bend, or they're going down the back straight, and Lauren is definitely closing. One last gasp attempt for Mark, but it looks like Lee's going to just hold on as they come across the line. It's Adams that's crowned under 21 champion. Mark Lauren in second place, he closed in a lot, but he just could not get there in the end. A great race in the runoff. Lee Adams of Australia, world under 21 champion. Mark Lauren of England, runner-up. Commiserations to him, but our congratulations must go to Lee Adams.
And well, certainly they must do, but Mark, with a valiant effort on that final lap. And, well, we did have a word with the new world champion after the meeting, and we'll look who we got to interview him.
I'd love to be doing the interview with Lee Adams, the 1992 world junior champion.
Yeah, but you put that all behind you, particularly in 1994 when you took the Commonwealth final and also reached your first ever world final.
Yeah, it was a good year. I started on laydowns, pretty much one of the front runners after Hans Nielsen the year before his success in Pocken. Klaus Lausch was doing my laydown bikes, and you know, I had something going good that year, and it certainly showed that when I won the Commonwealth final and then went on to the laydown for the world semi-final, and I had a really outstanding meeting. You know, on the day, I think I got the track record and things were going pretty good, so I was that little bit more quicker than anyone, and won the semi-final at Bradford, and that put me in good stead for Voyens for my first ever world final. It was good.
I mean, that must have been quite an experience for you.
Yeah, that's it. It was brilliant because obviously it was the last of the old world finals, and again I had good machinery in that. I was a bit overwhelmed, you know, as it'd been my first world final, and it was a one-day world final, so you know, it's one meeting as opposed to the new series, the Grand Prix series. So it was difficult, but you know, as usual, I give it my best shot, and I think it ended up equals six, which, you know, I was over the moon about, plus the fact it did qualify me through for the Grand Prix series, so it's good.
And well, Mark started steadily enough in his first ever world senior final, scoring 5 points from his first three. Let's take a look at the restart of heat number 14. Hans Nielsen having been controversially excluded.
Here will move up on 10 points, and that will be joint in the lead with Greg Hancock as they move away. And Boyce seems to be moving like a man possessed. He's in front. Second place, it is Larame. In third place, it is Larson, carrying a wrist injury. We hear that Craig Boyce, now then. We haven't had an Australian world champion since the early 50s, the late and still lamented Jack Young, but Boyce has suddenly seen this world final open for him. Larame is chasing hard after him, and Larame is right on his tail, and Larame is aware that Boyce has twice been taken around the outside. He lost one, he held on to another one, but Larame, needing points for a qualification in the Grand Prix, has really got a fluster gut here. He switches down the inside of Boyce, and he moves inside Boyce there and moves him over, and this is disastrous for the Australian. Good news for Larame. Larame actually powers back. He really kidded him there, moved to the outside, fainted the outside, then moved down the inside, and now Larame in front into the last lap and is in trouble. The bike is coughing. The bike definitely coughed there, and that's allowed Craig Boyce back in, and the drama is just coming up thick and fast right through this meeting. Oh, Boyce then moves into the joint lead with Greg Hancock. Who would have odds that before the meeting? And Larame, who had worked terribly hard and had moved him over, must be looking down at despair in his machinery, because after he'd gone by, the bike, it may have been some kind of fuel problem. It gave a cough, and that just allowed Craig Boyce back in. Dramatic stuff. You can see here, Larame just takes Boyce out of the way. Now, some referees might have interpreted that as being rough riding, but he's moved him over. And he's setting sail here. This is the last lap. And the bike just gives a cough, and that lets Boyce back in at Speedway Racing.
And we'll take a look at Mark's last ride. A good race needed to qualify for the 95 Grand Prix Series. He's on 7 points. This is the restart of Heat 17.
Knudsen, Larame, Stackman, Gustafsson. That's the lineup. They all need points. They all have something to go for. Time, it's a clean break, and this time Knudsen moves over from that line and moves them all over, and Gustafsson got a fearful knock at the first corner. Knudsen's in front. In second place it's Mark Larame, and the battle is on for the odd points at the back, and Henke Gustafsson, who must have been dreaming quite purposefully about a possible world championship, he's moved up into third place, but he had again the most awful first turn, got knocked wide, missed the start. He's starting his Achilles heel. But Knudsen here is in front with Mark Laram in second place. Now, Tommy Knudsen started with two race wins, then had a third place, changed his bike. It looks like he might be back on his other bike here because he's certainly cutting up the pace. He will be saying, well, World Final 1994, I like the beginning, I quite like the end, but I didn't like the middle. Two races, only 1 point. Second place, Mark Laram. Third place, Gustafsson. Two races to go. He must have thought the gods were smiling on him. Now, he'll be just happy to qualify for the Grand Prix. Heat number 17 and a win for Tommy Knudsen. He started with a win, he's ended with a win.
Yeah, well, Mark scoring a very credible 9 points then on his world final debut. So the last ever one-off world final, qualifying for the 95 Grand Prix series.
So good time at Kings Lynn, and certainly it was a track that suited your racing style.
Yeah, it was an enjoyable few years, you know. The trouble with Kings Lynn is I think them few years I did tend to stand still a little bit, you know, I didn't make the progress I was hoping to. A lot of that was down to my style of riding and the track being too forgiving for me, really. You know, it was getting to the stage where, you know, it wasn't so important for me to make a start, because every Saturday night at Kings Lynn I used to just go and enjoy riding there and used to be able to pick my way past. But when it got to the big individual meetings, I think I suffered for that, you know. But as far as the track goes and the people, I mean, I was always welcome there. And, you know, when Henker joined the team and that, we had a brilliant team up there. Good Stephen Davis and Richard Knight and everyone. It was a good, enjoyable few years. And the first year I went there, I actually went in as reserve. And went, you know, went from reserve in the team to the following month, the green sheet averages to number one, which was, you know, it was something else. I'd have a hell of a first year. You know, stepping up again really showed that, you know, I could get in amongst them.
Oh, well, Mark certainly proved that he could get amongst them, especially in the first year, as we see here, the match against Oxford, and he's out against the main Dane, Hans Nielsen. Our thanks to MBI Videos for this footage.
It's a good start for Mark Laram. And Mark really did make a jet-propelled gain that time. Nielsen in second place, Dean Barker has come up to challenge. In fact, now it's Barker who's moved into second, with Nielsen third, and Bo Brill making some impression there on Hans Nielsen. And this really is a bit of a surprise. It's not very often that you see Hans Nielsen anywhere except at the front here at Kings Lynn. But Laurent certainly showing tremendous form to start the meeting off. Well, this has got to be a confidence boost for not only Mark himself, but for the Zeta Stars to get a good result in Heat 1. Normally sets you up for the whole meeting. So Mark Laram looking extremely stylish. And he's set to take the honours in our first race of the night. So Mark takes a 3 points. Second place for Dean Barker. And a third for Hans Nielsen. Three all in a heat, and of course the score the same after the first race. Kings Lynn 3 and Oxford 3.
Yeah, well, now we'll take a look at Mark in his next heat.
So it's Dugard who makes an excellent start. Richard Knight in hot pursuit. Mark Laram right around the outside. Laram almost alongside Dugard. Leg trailing style, he really is a spectacular lad, looking stylish and smooth as ever. It's still Martin Dugard who's got the advantage, but here comes once again Mark Laram. And Laram just kept that extra bit of speed on. Dugard's far from finished though. So at the moment the Zeta Stars fighting back because Richard Knight's holding third. Gotta watch out for Martin Dugard, who really does love this place. See, he enters that corner, it's a little bit awkward, and that has left plenty of room for Mark Laram. As we hit the final lap, it's Laram. Dugard has drifted very wide. We thought Richard Knight was maybe going to be able to come through on that. But indeed, a heat advantage for the Zeta Stars. Amazingly, the first one of the night. That's a 4-2. And now only 2 points between the teams
It's 17 to Kingsley and 19 to Oxford.
Gain number three. Well, the Cheetahs went on to win that match, Mark, scoring very well, though, 15 points at the end of the season. Again, he decided to go out to South Africa for the South African tour, and we'll take a look at a couple of races from the beginning of 1991. Let's join Steve Van Straten.
That's our lineup, Norum, Louis, Moran, and Nordea. Mark Lorem off the gate and on the market to turn one out ahead. Chris Louis challenging on the inside. Nick, Killer Moran on the outside in the dirt. And the little man swings by. Temporarily in second place, now moving up. Mark Lorem still holding on to that first place. Killer Moran on the outside in the rough dirt. Trying the outside sweep. Chris Louis now losing a little bit of ground. Two more left. Kelly Moran still rushing on the outside. Moran down the back straight. Lorem picks up their wheel and scares the hell out of Moran. One more lap coming. Kelly Moran up around on the outside. Final lap coming up. How way is it going to be, Moran? Lorem or Louis? Final turn. Kelly Moran on the outside all the way through this race. Down to the line. Moran. Lorem. Louis. Woo!
Well, what a fantastic race. Now let's take a look at the meeting the following week, the international best pairs.
What can we say about that man, Moran?
And well, what indeed, Kelly, of course, a great rider in his time. And well, this, so as we say, the following week, Mark's got his chance of revenge.
Now making the fourth rider in the four-man lineup is down on gate number one, Mark Lorem, which is Warren Meyer's team pairing mate. One and three paired and two and four. This is event 17. Kelly Moran down from gate three, up around on the outside, moves up into the lead down lap one. Behind him is Mark Lorem. Then Warren Meyer back paddling in the fourth. He's got Noddy Nordea ahead of him. Nordea on eight in third place, and riding bike number two back and forth is Warren Meyer. Getting off a bad gating position off four. Out of front, Mark Lorem trying to keep tabs on Kelly Moran. Moran out there riding on bike number seven, and up on the inside is Mark Lorem. Lorem up on the inside of Kelly Moran with one lap to come. Moran now fighting up around on the outside. Down the back straight, the final turn coming out of the checkered flag at Canopy. Mark Lorem, Kelly Moran. Woo! What a race! The old and the new. Woo! And who the hell finished third?
Well, indeed, who and hell did. What a fantastic race, though. Mark getting his revenge over Kelly.
Takes some doing, indeed. Wow. They got out there and did it.
Now let's take a look at Mark in the Barham Trophy at Saddlebow Road, as it was known then, of course. Now the Norfolk Arena, this in 1992, the semi-final stage.
Out of the pole position, and Gary Havelock, we just pan back here, we'll see Gary Havelock in white. There he is, and he's in grid three, which has been one of the more productive lanes. On the outside it is Gary Allen, and he might well be a spoiler here. It's going to be a mad charge up to the first turn. If Nielsen gets the drop, and he has in most of his races, he'll swing them wide, and Havelock will attack down the outside. First semi-final, two to qualify. It is a flying start, and it's Havelock that gets away. Havelock in front, second place is Nielsen, third place is Loram, and Loram going through inside Nielsen, and Hans Nielsen, who had looked immaculate, is now in distinct danger of not qualifying. Sensational. We are really down to the nitty-gritty now, and Gary Havelock, who's had four meetings with Nielsen, hasn't won one of them, but now he is showing the Triple X World Champion a very, very clean pair of heels. Well, this indeed is one of the charms if you are successful, and one of the debits if you're unsuccessful with this format. Hans Nielsen hasn't really looked like being beaten right throughout the qualifying races. They now have 342 metres, just less, of Kings Lynn, and it looks like he is not going to qualify for the final, and that really is amazing. Havelock getting his act together just when it's necessary. He wins it. Loram is second, and Nielsen sensationally doesn't qualify.
Mark, you weren't too optimistic beforehand, but what can you say about that?
Yeah, I don't like to be too sort of confident, you know. Track was, though they watered it, it was a bit greasy, and but I'd made a reasonable start, which makes a change, and managed to sneak under him on the first turn, and managed to get through the final. I'm happy, you know, it just goes to show how unlucky you can be. 15 points, and then one bad race, and he's out. That's the way it goes.
Mark went on to finish third in the Barham Trophy behind Henrik Gustafsson and Brian Carger. The following year we take a look at some action. 93, the 14 tournament round at Arena Essex.
Well, it is Mark Lauren for King's Lynn who leads the way. Here comes Peter Raun on the inside. Martin Dugard back in third with Ben Howe at the back. But it is the King's Lynn skipper leads the way with Peter Raun. He's trying to find a way through on the inside as he come into the lead. Well, Lauren fighting back again once more on the outside. What superb speedway action this is in heat number six. And here comes Raun once more on the inside. Martin Dugard, well, there's nothing he can do about this. The Eastbourne Eagle back in third with Ben Howe in last place. Raun once more, he's moved through into the lead. Mark Lauren in second place trying to switch back to the inside. Has he got the necessary drive with a lap to go? It's very close indeed. Lauren, well, he takes the lead now. Peter Raun, he locks up slightly coming out of that second turn, and it looks as if Lauren has done enough to win this race. But Peter Raun, well, he's fighting back once more. Lauren, well, he looks over his shoulder, he just gets the victory.
Oh, well, now let's take a look at Mark in action the following year. This time at Ipswich.
Thomas DePinker. In blue it is Shane Parker, and in white it's that man, once again Mark Lauren, who comes here out in white off gate number four. Baramski winner first time out. The Ipswich riders, they suffered a 5-1 against Richard Knight and Bobby Ott in their first ride together. Will they fare any better in heat number five as the tapes rise? And well, it's Shane Parker indeed who's made the best start, and he leads the way from Mark Lauren in second place, Thomas DePinker in third with Mitch Shearer at the back. But it is Parker the Australian who leads the way, the want-away rider. Put in a transfer request at mid-season, but he's still with the Witches. At the moment, Mark Lauren, well, he's trying to find a way past former Witch, of course, himself, back in 89, but then went to Saddlebow Road. Made his first world final this year, and well, he's having a terrific battle here with Shane Parker. Thomas DePinker, he's still holding on to third spot ahead of Shearer. Parker, well, he's done nothing wrong at the moment, a lap in which to hold on. And it looks as if he's going to do so. Although here comes Lauren. He's going to leave it to another late challenge. Is he going to find a way past as Parker drifts out slightly? And Laramski, well, he gets there right on the line. Another tremendously close finish involving the King's Lynn number one. He wins it. Second place goes to Parker. Third spot to Thomas DePinker. A 4-2 for the visitors then. And the match, well, it ended up as a draw, 48 points each. It really was a vital win for Mark in heat number five.
Oh, well, now let's take a look at Mark in action in individual meeting. This is the Commonwealth final at his home track in 1994. And when he's won his first two rides, this is heat number 12.
A competitive heat this one could really be. Away we go then, on the outside in yellow and black, it's Andy Smith. Gary Havelock is at the rear and has it all to do at the moment, but going out front is Jeremy Doncaster with a challenge for Andy Smith. Where are the two that matter? Mark Laram's back in third and Gary Havelock is at the back, but there's Gary Havelock with nobody behind him at the moment, and he's got it all to do. But out front in yellow and black is Andy Smith. The battle is joined. The British champion is trying to get his first points of the day, but going round the outside is Mark Laram on his home track, showing that he knows every inch of it. Mark Laram riding a brilliant race here. The pressure is on. Laram is chasing Smith. Laram goes round the outside of Smith. A marvellous ride from the young man from King's Lynn to take the lead ahead of Andy Smith. Back in third place is Jeremy Doncaster, who's pushing for second, and Gary Havelock, a disappointing place right at the back of the field, but no such problem for the marvellous Mark Laram, who's showing just what local track knowledge can do and just what riding talent he has. Mark Laram clenches his fist as he goes across the line ahead of Andy Smith and Jeremy Doncaster, with Gary Havelock tailed off at the back. The thumbs up there from Mark Laram. Three wins out of three gives him a 9-point return and puts him in front. Either of them win it.
Mark went on to get a second place in his next ride behind Martin Dugard, who finished on 13 points. We're coming to the final race. Both Mark and Joe Scream were on 11 points apiece. A win for either rider would give them the Commonwealth title.
Very, very tight first corner here.
Joe Scream on the inside in red. He's had 11 points so far. Lee Adams in blue, 9 points. Steve Schofield, 4. Only a heat victory would put him among the qualifiers. And Mark Loram on the outside with 11 points, certain of a rostrum place and possibly the title for the Kingsland rider on his home track. Here we are for heat number 20, a grand finale to a fine meeting. Away from the tapes and on the inside is Joe Scream that makes it first to the bend, but round the outside is Mark Loram. The Ram is fast, Scream is faster. Through comes the Ram to take Scream on the inside. Quite a surprise that. Tailed off at the back is Steve Schofield, which Malwin beats. We know the eighth that will qualify. But out front is Mark Loram, and if he holds it there, that will give him the title. In second place is Joe Scream, who'll need to have a ride-off with Martin Dugard for the runners-up spot. But out front at the moment, there is Mark Loram, who's ridden so well. Joe Scream is pressing him. Joe Scream is coming up well. There's Mark Loram on the outside. Lee Adams is battling in second place. Lee Adams comes through and Scream is back in third. But there is Mark Loram out front. In second place now is Lee Adams. And Joe Scream is back with a lap to go. Mark Loram in front. Mark Loram from Lee Adams. Joe Scream suffering a bit. Back in third place now. And Steve Schofield at the back. But Mark Loram from King's Lynn is going to win this. Mark Loram takes the title, does the wheelie. Mark Loram ahead of Lee Adams and Joe Scream, which gives the title to Mark Loram with 14 points. Four race victories and a second place have given the King's Lynn man the title. He waves to his home fans. He shakes hands with Lee Adams down at the back straight. Disappointment for Joe Scream. Vital mistakes for him there in the third lap. But really, Mark Loram has deserved this title, and it means that Martin Dugard will take second place and Joe Scream will finish third. We don't need a ride-off. We know who makes the rostrum, but it's certainly England. 1, 2 and 3 here this afternoon.
1, 2, 6 out!
And so a big day for Mark as he receives the bumps, winning his first senior title.
Possible.
And so as Mark receives the trophies, having been crowned the Commonwealth champion, let's go and rejoin him, talking with Bryn.
But when it did, we saw some fine speedway.
So anyway, after that enjoyable spell at King's Lynn, a surprise move and a move down to Exeter in the West Country.
Yeah, it all come about when I think the Saturday night tracks all basically tended to throw the towel in with the new Grand Prix system. They didn't, you know, Buster Chapman, the new owner at King's Lynn that year, was not happy about the sort of Grand Prix riders and Saturday nights, and it was interfering with my Polish League commitments and, you know, open meetings and the rest of it. So unfortunately we had a little bit of crosswords, and ended in me being available on the transfer list that year. And that's where Exeter stepped in, because that year there was an amalgamation of leagues, and Exeter needed a top rider. It was Monday nights, and the track suited me, and I think it taught me a lot, because the way the track is there, I felt it was going to do me a bit of good, because it was important to make starts, and it's not a track for heroics. So that was really a bit of a turning point, really, in a lot of ways in my career.
I mean, many people might have been surprised by the move, and a lot of riders don't like Exeter because of the safety fence, which is a bit unforgiving, to say the least, isn't it?
Yeah, like I said, it's not a track for heroics. The fence, you know, there's no getting away from the fact that it's not the safest track. It's quite dangerous. But, if you use your noodle and ride there within your capabilities, which unfortunately I think a lot of the crashes down there are because riders aren't doing that. But as far as riding now, I enjoyed every minute of it. And both the people and Colin Hill were just, you know, really laid great foundations for me to have a couple of really enjoyable seasons there. And I'm sure if it had been the case where he had been in the first division or top flight speedway now, I'd still be there, you know, to this day.
Yeah, I mean, Colin, despite all his critics down in the West Country, has really kept Speedway afloat at Exeter, and as well as yourself, of course, he brought in Simon Wigg.
Yeah, that's it, and that was a turning point for the Falcons as a whole. We, you know, were sort of struggling a bit, and good at home, good home track riders, but unfortunately the old boys struggled a little bit away, and brought Simon in, and with, like me, a former grass track rider, and, well, current grass track rider he was at the time, and the track suited him, and yeah, it turned the team and the year round. It was a thoroughly enjoyable season, you know, it's good.
So this pairing, well, now let's take a look at Mark in action for the Falcons, this a bank holiday Monday morning meeting against the mighty Wolverhampton. Coming to the last race, the Falcons lead by a couple.
2 points, Exeter, they need 3 points to score a memorable victory themselves. No wonder the riders are taking their time coming up to the start line. Some cracking speedway action here this morning. Will it be the Falcons or the Wolves who are victorious? Will it be a draw? We're about to find out. Ermolenko off one, Lorem off two, Boyce off three, Fry from the outside, don't forget him. Heat number 16, the all-important start as they go towards the first turn, and it looks like Lorem has made it. He leads the way, Craig Boyce, but he's trying to come through to second place. Sam Ermolenko and Paul Fry were there having a battle for third, but it is Mark Lorem who leads the way. Here comes Boyce on the inside, trying to close in the four riders, where they're all in a line coming down the home straight, but it is Mark Lorem who's still out in front. This should be enough to give extra victory, as Sam Ermolenko looks over and he sees that he's been passed by Paul Fry, who's come through in the third place. Exeter, well, this will be a famous win for them. Mark Lorem leads with a couple of laps to go. Craig Boyce holding on to second place, but it's not going to be good enough with Paul Fry in third. Ermolenko is in last position. Lorem, who's been beaten by both Boyce and Ermolenko this morning, he's going to gain sweet revenge in the final race to give Exeter victory. He only needs to go for another half a lap. Craig Boyce, no way past for him. The Exeter number one has ridden a terrific race, as has Paul Fry. And we'll listen to the applause from the fans here this morning. What a match. Paul Fry, he came through in the third place. A 4-2 for Exeter. They win by 50 points to 46. And we'll want an advert for Speedway.
Now let's take a look at some of the away action involving the Exeter number one in this one. He is actually guesting for Middlesbrough against Ipswich at Foxhall Heath at the beginning of the season. He comes in as a tactical substitution in heat six. As they come out of the start, and well, it's very close indeed, but Mark Lorem, well, he's been pushed out wide by Jeremy Doncaster, but then he's trying to fight his way back into this race. Lee Lanham it is who leads the way. Here comes Lorem though on the inside, full throttle as ever. Jeremy Doncaster, well, he's been pulled out wide now by Mark, with Lanham still leading the way. And well, Luramski's coming under pressure once more from Donkey, who's trying to close in. Lee Lanham still out in front though. Terrific race this in heat number six. The crowd were there cheering on their favourites. Lanham, well, he's went a little bit slow into that corner. Is Long going to find a way past one? No, he does not. Lanham, he's holding him off. What a ride this is by the Ipswich number two with a lap to go. It is still Lee Lanham leading from Mark Lorem in second place. This is his last chance as they come round to the finish line as they cross it. Well, in fact, it looks as if Mark Lorem got up right on the line. That really was true. Well, indeed he did. What a magnificent effort by Mark in that one. And well, now we'll see him back at the county ground the following year. This is the match against Swindon, heat number one.
Between the Falcons and Swindon gets underway. And well, in fact it is Nielsen who's made the start from Mark Lorem in second place. Mark Simmons making his reappearance. Well, he was back in third, but the rider in yellow and black, that's Adam Mockridge, he's come through in the third spot now. So it is the Robins who hold the heat advantage. Jimmy Nielsen, well, he really has improved vastly at this track. Used to hate coming down this place 2 or 3 years ago, but he really has learned to master it.
As you can see in heat number one, he leads from Mark Lawler in second place, although the Ramsey is not that far behind. Adam Aldridge is in third, so the Robins, they hold a heat advantage. The track where it looks very well prepared here this evening, one lap to go, and Dewey Nielsen still leads the way. Mark Lawler, well, he's not giving up, and well, he's trying to come around the boards on the outside of Nielsen. It looks like he's succeeded as they go down the back straight. The roar goes up from the crowd as the extra number one comes through into first place. Tremendous stuff in the very first race. Well done to Mark. Second place goes to Jimmy Nielsen. Third spot to Adam Aldridge. So a share.
What a great winning start then for Mark in heat number one.
And we're now the same meeting, heat number 10. Exeter leading by a couple. Mark Lawler, he's unbeaten after his first two outings. See what sort of start he can make in heat number 10, where he's not made a good one. Mark Simmons there, so. And surprisingly, Simmo's out in first place. John Jorgensen in second. Jorgensen, well, he's trying to come through on the inside, but Simmons, well, he's done very well indeed to hold him off as they come around to complete the first lap. He looks over to see where Jorgensen is, and he's not far behind Mark Lawler. Well, again, he's got to do his work from the back. Steve Masters, he's in last place with a fine race in heat number 10 against Simmons, but he's coming under immense pressure from Jorgensen, but he's still holding on to the lead. Mark Lawler, well, he's not far behind either. So it seems a good racing down here at the county ground this evening. Again, Laramski, well, he's hoping to get a maximum, but he's got to find a way past Jorgensen. Mark Simmons, well, again, he's still holding on to the lead. Here comes Laramski on the outside. Well, they're on the final lap, but Jorgensen, well, he won't give up. He's still managing to split the two Falcons, but nor will Mark Lawler. He's gone from the outside. He's switching to the inside. Tremendous action in heat number 10, and Laramski's come through into the second place. Well, amazing stuff here at the county ground. Mark Simmons is going to win the race, but Mark Lawler gets second place, and the crowd go mad. John Jorgensen gets a point in third. Well, it really was quite excellent speedway in heat number 10. Great win there for Mark Simmons, but what a second place for Mark Lawler. And no wonder the crowd are on their feet, and no wonder the riders are going around for a lap of honour. Great stuff, fully deserved.
Well, the
for
Falcons
them.
Went on to a magnificent 6-point victory. Mark just missing out on a paid maximum. Just after we had a few words with him. That's what he had to say to Nigel.
And also John Jorgensen.
Right, man of the match this evening, as presented by Bradford's. You've had a fantastic evening, Mark. There's some great entertainment along the way, and a good win for the Falcons as well.
Yeah, that's right. Obviously, I prefer to make starts, but I guess it's a bit more interesting for people watching if I don't. But the track was pretty good tonight. I was missing starts, which I wasn't very happy with, and I think I was getting a bit angry with myself when I was out there, so I think, you know, that helped in a way.
When you were behind John Jorgensen and when Mark was leading earlier on, obviously, had you got past John, there wasn't a lot of room up in front to get past and up behind Mark, but eventually you did squeeze through. It was a bit hairy there at one moment.
Yeah, that's right. Obviously, you've got to be very careful what you're doing, because there's no point in going silly and crashing and, you know, and hurting yourself. So I just had to try and take everything into account and just try and squeeze by, and then without taking too many chances. But that, you know, worked out right, and I managed to squeeze by, but it isn't easy.
Riders off gates 2 and 3. Well, now we can see Mark on his travels once more for the Falcons, this time at Hackney against the London Lions, heat 11. Lights on as the tape rise. Important start, and it looks like Laramski's missed it. Indeed he has, as Kelvin Tatum takes the lead. Michael Coles is back in third over John Wainwright. Here comes Lauren though on the inside of Tatum, but Kelvin, well, he's riding a good line, although he's drifted out a little bit wide, but there's plenty of drive out there. But Lauren, well, as he comes through into the lead, it looks as if he has, although Kelvin, well, he's fighting back again. A good race this in heat number 11. Neither rider wanting to give way, and Tatum, well, he's gone closer to the white line in that one, and he's still out in first place. Well, here comes Lauren once more on the inside. What a good race this is. And this time Kelvin, well, he's just drifted off the line, and it's allowed Laramski through in the first place. But a cracking heat in race number 11. The track, well, it hasn't really been conducive to great racing so far this season, but of course very new indeed. Only had a handful of meetings on it. Going to take a while to bed in, but that was a fine race in heat number 11, probably our best so far at Wolfden Road, as Mark gets the verdict.
Well, Mark had his first defeat in heat number 13. Lee Adams beat him. Lee was unbeaten going into the last race. Could Mark get his revenge?
The final race gets underway, and Adams and Larson have again made fast starts. They lead the way. Mark Lorham is back in third with Paul Fry in last position. And with the Lions pair, they obviously aware that Laramski is going to try all he can to find a way past. They completed the first lap. Lee Adams still out in front. Josh Larson holding on to second place, but here comes Laramski on the inside. He's closing in as they come round to complete the second lap. And is he going to find a way past the American on the inside? It's very close indeed. Larson, well, he certainly knows Mark is there. And here he comes on the inside, the extra number one. He's moved through into second place. Has Josh got any answer to this? Well, indeed he has, as he switched back and on the inside, and he's come through into second spot once more. It's all happening in this final race. Lee Adams, well, he's oblivious to it. Mark Lorham, well, he's gone out wide and he's cut back on the inside again. He's moved through into second place. What a final race to finish with, as Lee Adams gets the victory in second place. Well, it just goes to Mark Lorham on the line. Well, easily the best race we've seen here on the reshaped Hackney circuit. Really was a tremendous race.
So two happy years at Exeter, and during that year you had individual success in the Grand Prix series, having clinched your place in that last ever world final at Boyens, and particularly the first year you were at Exeter, that was highly successful as far as the Grand Prix were concerned.
Yeah, two A finals to start them off. It was pretty good. I think in the end finished up fifth. Is that right? Yeah, fifth that year, I think, which is, it was good. Like, it was the first year of the Grand Prix, and again, things were pretty much on track. You know, I was pretty happy with that.
And in 1996, though, a little bit of a struggle, but it all came good in the end at both Boyens and Hackney, and that kept you in the series for the following year.
Yeah, that's it. Was the year Billy Hamill won the title, and followed him home in the A final, second place. It was a good result. Like you say, I had struggling up until then, and two good results to end the season. And winning the B final at Hackney secured my place, eighth place, for the, you know, to avoid the Grand Prix challenge.
Yeah, I mean, you must have been delighted to avoid that meeting in particular.
Yes, certainly now having been in one, it's not an enjoyable experience. You know, it's not very nice at all. I think with that under 21 final race and the Grand Prix challenge this year, certainly made hard work of that, and it's, you know, it's not nice to be in.
So good 2 years to start off your Grand Prix series then in 95 and 96.
Yeah, that's it. Good results, and like I say, I felt I was getting somewhere and slowly climbing up the ladder after a couple of stale years on the international front, so it was good.
Well, now let's take a look at Mark in action in the Grand Prix series. This his very first Grand Prix race in Poland in 95.
And they really are taking a long time to settle. This is heat number three. Into that first corner, who will be the first to show it? Smith. Smith is away, that's a surprise. Nielsen on the inside, on the outside it is Mark Lorham. And it's the two Brits in front, and the Union Jacks are waving, with Lorham now going around the outside and switching back inside Smith. Has he got the drop? Still in touch is Nielsen, and this time Lorham bursts down the inside and he moves into the lead there, and Nielsen follows him through against Smith, although Smith is aware of Hans Nielsen, and Nielsen has work to do. Well, this is good news for the British contingent, with Mark Lorham picking off his fellow countrymen, and Andy Smith having all kinds of problems with Hans Nielsen climbing all over him. Every point, of course, vital. And this time it looks like Nielsen has gone down through the inside. He moves into second place, but he's got a lot of work to do to catch up with Mark Lorham. Lorham is really steaming.
Well, he certainly was, and he made it all the way through to the very very first A final. And, well, we'll take a look at him in that.
Three ahead of Hans Nielsen. He's the one to watch, perhaps, because he has a very, very, very special reason for pulling this one out of a fire. Hans Nielsen on the inside, Golub, then the two Brits, Lorham and Louis. The outside grids have been very, very useful. But Nielsen said, I'm going to go inside, which can only mean one thing. He is going to swing him into that first turn. has to be careful. If he leaves a hole, the guys here are capable of whipping into it. Here we go, the final, and away we go, and it's Nielsen who scores. Nielsen in front, Nielsen swings out, and has left a hole for Dollar. We thought that just might happen, and Nielsen obviously feel the English threat. He swung out, he's coming back at Thomas Gollum, and Ratzlaff is on its feet, because as Nielsen swung out, Gollum saw his opportunity. He was absolutely through it like lightning. And although Hans Nielsen is getting back on the inside, Gollum is out in the dirt, and the Poles love to screw it on, and he is looking very good. And his tactics were absolutely perfect. He sensed, I'm sure, if he didn't start, that Nielsen would swing out. He waited back, he took his opportunity, and, well, he is going for gold. Nielsen is second, not making any inroads. We're into the last lap, 400 metres around here. In third place, it is Chris Lewis. But it'll be fascinating to watch that one again, because one has to suspect if Hans Nielsen had just kept his head down and raced instead of being worried about the opposition, he might not have let that amount of space open for this rider. Thomas Gollum is the first ever Grand Prix A-grade winner, and listen to that crowd.
So a very creditable fourth place for Mark in his first ever Grand Prix. As by the time he came to the last one, at a very wet London Stadium, he needed a good finish. Let's take a look at heat number five. He'd won his first race.
Laram, who won his first ride, he'll be on the outside. Hans Nielsen, of course, such an interested spectator as heat number five gets underway again, and from the outside, it's a tremendous start from Laram. He just had the advantage, and he really piled across the field. Marvin Cox rode a very, very difficult first corner and got just chopped out of sight. He really did it all wrong there, it has to be said. But Laram did it absolutely to perfection. He got the start from the outside, came straight across the field. He's entitled to make his own line. He's in front. In second place there, it is Billy Hamill. In third place, it is Tommy Knudsen. And Knudsen certainly is not the influence or force he was midway through this Grand Prix series. You can see the distance. Tommy, I fancy, is not too keen on wet conditions. They're coming into the last lap now, of course. The diagonal flag there with the lady start line marshal from Peterborough in her colourful hunting gear. Mark Laram is giving the Brits plenty to cheer about. That's his second race win. Second place was Hamill. Third was Knudsen.
And Mark did extremely well making it through to the A final. Let's take a look. Could he finish on the rostrum for the first time?
Britain did to Mark Laram. The crowd would just raise the clouds if he could manage to get away here, but it's a tall order. Mid three has Henrik Gustafsson, unpredictable. Can look like a champion, not look quite so impressive in other races. And Greg Hancock on this outside grid, which has proved so very, very advantageous. Here we go, the A final, Hancock's away. Oh, Hancock comes right across the field. In second place, it is Henrik Gustafsson with Sam Ermolenko going past him there and running him right past the corner. Oh, that really was a terrible piece of cornering from Henrik Gustafsson. He was helped on his way by Sam Ermolenko, but it allowed Mark Laram to come through. But the British crowd are willing Laram on, but surely he's not going to catch this guy out front. Greg Hancock in front from the start. Again, there was an inevitability about that. Mark Laram is bursting, trying hard to give the British crowd one last crumb of success here. Well, he's made the A final. Gustafsson's tailed off. They're into the last lap, so we've been right across Europe. We've had some terrific racing. We've had some marvellous incidents. We've had, above all, great pitches. We've had wonderful crowds, terrific spirit. The last moments of the 1995 Grand Prix bring victory in Britain at Hackney for Greg Hancock. Second place there, Sam Ermolenko. In third place for Britain, it was Mark Laram. But the night belongs to Greg Hancock. The championship belongs to Hans Nielsen. With the dirt on the apparel
of so many of the bystanders. Mark Laram takes third place in the British Grand Prix to give satisfaction to the British crowd.
Yeah, well, that certainly did. And well, now let's take a look at Mark in action the following year. This the Swedish Grand Prix in Linköping, heat number 14.
Would be helpful if we could start. And Andy Smith on the outside in yellow and black. Tension. E number 14, away they go, and Nielsen certainly hasn't made it from the outside of the Smith, and from the inside it's Lee Adams. And Laram got a terrible knock there going into that corner. It looked like Nielsen might have been the Gibson man, and Nielsen's back in third place. In fact, he's back way at the back now. You can see Hans Nielsen and Mark Laram in contention here. And it was a very hectic first quarter, but here goes Nielsen again, has taken Laram out, and he's all over the place, and this is hardly the start of a champion. Don't let's forget, while we're watching the real elbows flying at the back, Lee Adams is away and going like the proverbial greyhound. He's in front, second place, it is Andy Smith, in third place, having a real ding-dong, it's Mark Laram, and it's Hans Nielsen. Here's the battle, and there's little love lost between these two because Nielsen seemed to run straight into Laram, and Laram really is now looking most determined. And what has happened to Hans Nielsen as they go over the line? Laram has gone by into third place. Nielsen seemed to slow up. It certainly left a gap. No doubt about the winner. That's that man there, Lee Adams. Second place was Andy Smith. But, well, for those of us who thought that Music Hall was dead, Hans Nielsen and Mark Laram were knocking great lumps off each other. Adams wins it, but really, it was quite a story at the back because he took a knock. This is Laram. He'd been knocked all over the place by Nielsen. Whether it was on purpose or not, it's a matter for conjecture. But certainly, he came through on the inside as he went by. Well, he wasn't wishing him happy birthday, was he? Well, maybe we'll have to fit microphones on helmets as well as cameras, because that was another of our controversial, but it must be said, magical moments. Let's watch the corner again. Nielsen's clearly out of sorts, does well there to avoid being squeezed out, but in so doing has left Mark Laram nowhere to go. Lee Adams, in all the drama, has ridden a suit. Look at Nielsen is ducking and diving, and there goes Laram under him, and this is hardly the performance of a Grand Prix champion. Now this is the battle again, and we wonder if we will see what happens. Laram is aware that Nielsen is out back, and Nielsen comes under him hard here. First corner, second lap, and now this is the moment when Nielsen lifts up and Mark Laram gets pushed out. He did well not to go roaring into the fence. He's shaking his head there. Well, it may be unintentional, but it was very naughty. And clearly, there was a little aggro between these two. Oof. Well, that's heat 14. Nielsen gets nothing from it. That's the big story.
DJ screen on there. On two Voyens in the Danish Grand Prix, the last one of the 96 season. Mark, well, as he said in his interview with us a little while ago, he needed a good finish in this one. Let's take a look at him in heat number 15.
Pumped up by the sight of his brother-in-law, Chris Louis, who suddenly got his act together in his last ride. Heat number 15, under orders. And there goes the tapes, and into that first corner, it's going to be a close call. And in front it is Carlson, and going around the outside it is Crump, and Laram's in the picture as well. And we can see here that it is Crump who leads it, and here comes Mark Laram around the outside, and he's gone around Carlson, and it looks like he has got Crump in his sights, and Mark Laram is riding right out of his socks here for Britain. That is superb. Absolutely, he was left at the start, he was back in third place, he picked off Carlson, no mean feat. He picked off Crump, who won at the London Grand Prix, and there was a battle for second place, but suddenly the Brits have burst into blossom here in Voyens, and there are some British fans here, and they're enjoying this because Louis has popped up, and now Laram, with just 300 metres to go, he's popped up to win a race, and they're both very much still in with a poke at qualifying without having to go to that vulture meeting in Prague for the Grand Prix Challenge. Laurent takes the flag. That is encouraging. Second place, Jason Crump. Third place, Peter Carson. Joe Screen sadly missed the traps.
And we're now on to a very dramatic final of the Danish Grand Prix. Mark needing a good finish in this one to keep his Grand Prix placing for the following year. Billy Hamill needing to win to claim the World Championship.
Grand Prix points will be distributed in this A final, and can Billy Hamill make the start from the outside that could carry him to glory in the A final here in the Danish Grand Prix? And away they go, and Hamill is away from the outside and hits the corner first. Hamill in front, second place is Hancock. Coming through hard is Mark Rohrer, and so too is Sam Ermolenko, and it is Ermolenko who's up into second place now, and the battle is really joined for these odd places with Hancock and Ermolenko together, and Mark Rohrer goes storming down the inside of them there to move into second place, and that really was the most impressive piece of cornering. Powerful stuff from Mark Rohrer. He is into second place, but it is Hamill in front, and Hamill is going for it, and Laram is right on his tail now. They're certainly giving it 100% here in this A final. He would expect nothing less if it stays this way with that battle. Hancock needs to stay here in third place to finish third overall, but it's all about Billy Hamill. Hamill going for the crown, going for glory here, and the Danish Grand Prix, they're absolutely locked together for second place with Hancock and Laram, and over the line there, Mark Laram just might have got up, but Hamill is who is the race winner, and that is the most heartbroken man in World Speedway. Hans Nielsen has seen his crown slip away. Hancock and Hamill are absolutely ecstatic, and Nielsen has the loneliest walk in the world.
Mark, just very quickly, you're through to the Grand Prix next year.
Yeah, I was a bit stressful there for a minute, but I've had a good meeting, and that's what I come here, I had to do, and I've done it, and I'm happy.
Certainly give it everything in that last race.
That's right, yeah, I knew, I was pretty sure that if I didn't get some points out of it, I'd have to have a runoff for the eighth place, so I was a bit down going into the race, but it sort of helped, and I just had everything to gain, nothing to lose.
And the runoff would have been against your brother-in-law.
Yeah, that would have been a horrible situation to be in.
But the good news is you're both there now.
Both of us, yeah?
I think so, yes.
I just hope he's in as well, that'd be great.
Okay, Mark, thanks a lot.
Cheers, thank you.
This, of course, is the presentation ceremony for the Danish Grand Prix. We should point out that we are expecting two presentations, but Mark Rohrer goes up there being second in the Danish final. That's the best British result we've seen in the Grand Prix, certainly this year, and he'll be heartened by that.
Well, at the end of 1996, an enforced move with Exeter going down to the Premier League, opting to go down there, and he went from one end of the country to the other, from Exeter to Bradford, and it turned out to be quite a year up there.
Yeah, it was good. Like you say, it's a shame. I didn't want to leave Exeter, but I can understand Colin Hill's reasons totally. You know, he dropped down to the divided leagues. Totally understood that. So I went on loan that following year to Bradford, where joined Javi and Screeny. Again, a track which was thoroughly enjoyable to ride every Saturday night. You know, looking forward to going up there and riding, and had a very good season. And to add to the good season was riding for a good couple in the Hams. You know, the Ham brothers were an excellent, well-organised setup, and that was a thoroughly enjoyable season, both with the promoters and good blokes in the team.
Yeah, I mean, it must be strange to have ridden with Joe Screen for that year, rather than against him, which he had been for the previous years.
Yeah, me and Joe are, you know, very good mates, and same with Chris. It's hard when you're riding against, you know, each other, and you know, it's hard to know how far to push it, but I think we all know our limits, and you know, we don't go too silly, and nobody would put anyone in any unnecessary danger, because we're good friends, and I think I can speak for them as well, whereas, you know, we've got respect for each other on the track as well as off it. So yeah, it was good.
So really a fabulous year at Bradford, and the icing on the cake, winning the league championship.
Yeah, very good. Good blokes to ride for the Hams, and a good track to ride at.
just a shame that we didn't get the support. You know, Bradford's a town where that year, or a city, that year they had, the rugby was very big there, and there just wasn't room for the Speedway, and Speedway was really struggling at the time, and it was unfortunate that, you know, it couldn't continue, because it is undoubtedly one of the best tracks in the league.
Well, as well as success on the team front, success on the individual front, another good season in the Grand Prix, and a marvellous victory in the British final at Coventry, where you defeated your old friend Chris Louis in a runoff.
Yeah, again, friends and racing, you know, it's difficult to know how far to go. But, you know, me, Chris and Joe were all good friends, and, you know, we've all had some really serious scraps on the track. But we know how far to push, and we know each other's limits, and we've got respect for each other, and the last thing we'd want to do is hurt each other. But, you know, that race at Coventry, a lot of people have said to me it's the best race, one of the best races I've ever seen in Speedway, which, you know, it's nice to be a part of it, and... for once, it was nice to be a part of it and come out winning, so, you know, it was good.
Well, unfortunately, there's no action available of Mark from Odsall, but we did catch him away the match at Hull.
Craig Boyce and Steve Schofield out against Mark Lorham and David Walsh as they come out of the start. And it is Steve Schofield who leads the way from Mark Lorham in second place. Craig Boyce, well, he's back in third ahead of David Walsh. The battle going on, though, for first spot as Scully leads the way from Little Hempsky in second place. Boyce, well, he's trying to get back on the action on the inside, but Mark, well, he's gone out very wide indeed, but he's got the speed to come back through into second place. Can Boyce find a way back past to join Scully for a 5-1? David Walsh, well, he's tailed off in this one, but now Lauren, well, he's going out very wide indeed once more, and he's got the drive, and, well, he's trying to find a way past Steve Schofield, as you can see, as they come round to start the final lap. The thrill merchant, Mark Lorham, well, it looks like he may have found a way past the clean as you whistle pass in heat number 10. He leads the way, and, well, Paul not going to reduce this 14 point deficit as Mark Lorham has won heat number 10. Second place to Steve Schofield, first spot to Craig Boyce. Laramski thrilling the crowds at Wimborne Road. V Bradford, this is heat number 15. The Dukes having already won the match, and with a four rise in this one, Kelvin Tatum guest in four, Craig Boyce in red and blue, it is Mark Lemon in white, Joe Screen in yellow and black, Mark Lorham as they come out of the start. Well, Kelvin Tatum has made a good gate, but watch here for Laramski, he's come around the outside into first place with Mark Lemon in second, Kelvin Tatum in third, Joe Screen, well, he's at the back, but he's fighting his way past Tatum into third spot. Mark Lorham it is then who leads the way, and, well, he's suffered just one defeat so far this evening. That was when Mark Lemon got the better of him, but Laramski, well, he's beating the Australian at the moment, and Joe Screen, well, he's also trying to close in on Lemo. Kelvin Tatum, well, he's at the back, but Mark Lorham still leads the way. All eyes on the battle for second between Mark Lemon and Joe Screen. Can the Screen machine find a way past to give Bradford a massive 20-point victory at Wimborne Road? They're on the final lap. Laramski still leads the way. Watch here for Joe Screen. He's on the outside line, switching back to the inside. Although it looks as if Lemo may just hold on. Joe, well, he's on a maximum. And, well, can he possibly find a way past? Well, he does, right on the line. He just gets the better of Mark Lemon. A 5-1 for Bradford to finish with. Joe gets his paid maximum.
Yeah, well, indeed, Joe did, and we did catch up with the Screen machine after this year's bonfire burn-up. This is what he had to say to Bree.
Champion.
Well, Joe, you and Mark, you go back a few years, don't you?
Yeah, we've sort of grown up all through the sort of junior grass track side of it. You know, we've sort of been competitive, both of us, all the way through, and sort of now it's good. We had a year at Bradford together, and, you know, it was one of the best seasons I've ever had. You know, I sort of look up to Mark, you know, his sort of racing style and everything sort of is similar to mine. You know, we both sort of leg trailers and all, you know, like chasing the dirt all the time, and we both sort of stood on the slick. So, you know, we both sort of the same sort of style riding, which is good.
Yeah, I mean, great rivals on the track, but good mates off of it.
Yeah, he's all right. He's not bad for a southerner, I should suppose. I say we get on well, you know. I speak to him sort of once or twice a week anyway, and, you know, he's into motocross as well as I am, so we're trying to set a date, you know, with the Speedway season. It's difficult, but in the off-season, we try and go motocrossing together, so, you know, he's a good old boy.
Yeah, I mean, I remember when I think he was 15, you used to come down to Hackney on an old Wes Lake helped to get her by bits of string and used to stay with Mark over the weekend?
Yeah, I think at the time he was staying with Graham Hurry. He stayed at Graham's and, sort of knew Mark from there. And, as I say, we grew up through the grass track side, so I sort of knew Mark before that. And he's a great friend.
Yeah, I mean, you both moved on, England internationals and in the Grand Prix as well.
I'd say when riding with Mark's brilliant. The year with Mark and this sort of this year in the England team, it's good. Every time Mark's sort of riding, you've got to give 110% with him, which I try and do anyway. But you don't see him that much on the grass track, as sort of somebody just shouted out there.
He used to do quite a bit of grass track, and you're good rivals here too.
Yeah, especially here. Every time he does this sort of the end of the season, he's not here today, which is a shame. But as I say, his style and his racing is unbelievable.
Right, any thoughts about him? Is he tight?
He's tight. He's tight at different, on his equipment, but I think his toys, what he plays with, is not tight. He's got a wicked manager in Norrie Allen.
Who leaves him on motorway services abroad, I understand.
He leaves him astray everywhere. That's about it, really. I don't really...
I expect you've got a few stories, but as this is a family video, we better leave those, yeah?
Yeah, a lot of stories, but keep them quiet.
Okay, Joe, thanks for talking to us.
Thank you.
Hit number nine coming away there.
Well, we were unable to get any footage of the Bradford Pulse Dukes at home, of course, the famed Oddsall Circuit, but we did get this, the Premier League Riders' Championship, a very wet Saturday, October afternoon. Thought you'd want to take a look at it. We do apologise for the quality of the sound and pictures, but at least we can see Mark in action at his home track in 97.
Oh, the outside grids are away again. Mark around this time rides out wide looking for Anderson. Stuffs him up there, leaves a gap. Peter Carlson's coming through. Martin Dugard's been squeezed out. But that was ruthless tactics, really, from Mark Moran. He seemed to know he'd made the start, Peter. He rode wide to counteract the thrust from Anderson, and he's looking away and going away like a greyhound now.
Yeah, Mark's got very, very fast equipment. He's done so well this year in the Grand Prix. He's winning that last one in Boyens. He knows that his bikes are good. He's just in the right place where you need to be when your bike's quick enough. But he got Brian Anderson on the outside of him on that start, but he knew he had to go for it. And he's just going away now for these 3 points.
Yes, they're into the last lap, 342 metres. And Martin Dugard, who had 5 points, is way, way at the back here. That's just how topsy-turvy and fascinating this meeting is. Laram back in the winning mould. He wins heat nine. Second place was Peter Carlson. Third was Brian Anderson.
So Mark winning that in front of his adoring fans. And well, he did in fact go out in the semi-final stage of meeting won by Sam Ermolenko, when Mark's great friend, of course, Chris Louis, he had engine failure when within sight of victory. And we'll just look at Mark's appearance when he was interviewed by John Davis after this race win. Something a little bit different.
Mark, home track specialist, home crowd behind you, feeling good?
Yeah, unfortunately I've got a lot of bike problems. They just don't feel right, Not quick enough really, but I'm sticking in there, doing my best.
Well, Mark certainly gave his best shot in the British final this year, and well, he and Chris Louis tied on 14 points. This one of the epic races of all time. Take a look at this.
And then he dropped his point to Havelock in heat five. So Louis on the inside, Mark Norham almost alongside him. Looks like Louis's got gate two, and Mark Norham's taking a rather wide gate three. So the runoff for the 1997 British Championship. Final race of the afternoon, the 22nd race. Louis again checking everything's okay. Both these, of course, in the Grand Prix already, but looking for that British crown this afternoon. Two riders settled. The Bradford fans roar on the pit corner. The Ipswich fans roar on the back straight. Green lights on. A clean break, and Lewis made a super start. The inside, Lauren gets it, and Lauren can't keep the front wheel in, but Lauren screws it on round the outside. Louis comes for the inside, Lauren again round the outside, and Louis left him nothing. Lauren almost went to the fence there, and that's cost him a few yards, and he clearly had the throttle back there because Chris Louis was about to leave him nothing, but Lauren's got four on the inside. That's a tremendous right there by Mark Lauren. He's gone wide again. Louis cuts back for the inside one, and Louis reaches
takes it. Mark again back around the outside as Lorham shows in from Millie. And that's a tremendous ride by Mark Lorham on that first lap. And Lewis back in contention again as they complete lap two. Lorham from Millie, two lights between them as they roar into that pit corner. Once in, Lorham's going wide. Millie gets on the inside, lifts it. He's left Lorham nothing. And as Mark Lorham thrown it away as Chris Millie roars back to the inside line. It's Millie 5-6 by Glenn Kerr and Lorham as they come on to start lap four. And Lorham makes a move on the inside and leaves Lorham nothing at all the outside of that pitch corner. And Lorham's not going to recover from that. And Mark Lorham is going to be the 1997 British champion. That's a real hard one up between those two. But it's Mark Lorham becomes British champion. Second place, Chris Lorham looked at Mark Lorham had thrown it. But he let Chris Lorham throw on the inside. But he took up the speed on that Coventry corner and went racing after Lorham. And he left Lorham absolutely nothing on that pitch corner. Lorham had to throttle back or go into the boards. And Mark Lorham is the 1997 British champion. That's from Bradford. Second from Ipswich, which is Chris Lorham. And former Bradford rider Sean Wilson gets the third place.
Chris Lorham right here. And the new British champion is Mark Lorham.
Certainly tremendous stuff. Let's give you the official result. The winner in white, that's Mark Lorham, in a time of 65.2 seconds. 65.2 then, the winning the runoff there. Second, of course, Chris Lorham. Mark celebrating around the straight there.
And well, what a brilliant ride that was by Mark and Chris then, and winning his first British title.
Well, the entourage coming onto the track now for the provisional bumps of the soon-to-be-crowned British champion, Mark Lorham. There we go. There it is, the STD trophy from David Hughes. Ladies and gentlemen, the British champion, Mark Lorham! Just while we're set up, we're just grabbing the Bradford fans. Mark Lorham, what a day!
Yeah, it's fabulous. You know, I haven't had a very good run at Coventry in the past year, so I had nothing to lose today, and I come here pretty relaxed, and I ended up winning it, so I'm over the moon.
What about that run-off between you and Chris?
Yeah, I think I would have liked it to be anyone else other than Chris, really, because, you know, we're such good mates, but we're both as hard on each other, I think, so that's just the way it goes. But that's 1-0 to me, and I don't look forward to another one, though.
I bet you don't. British champion, Mark Lorham. Photo call then for the members of the press who are with us today. And those of us know, like Terry Russell and myself, to move back because the champagne is about to fly. And it does. There you go. Out, everybody. Sean Wilson, quickly, Mark Lorham.
So, British champion, and also you won the very first Grand Prix of your career in Denmark in that year.
Yeah, it was a good season for me as a whole. I was having a good year with Bradford, and a good year on the individual front as well. And what topped off was that winning Voyens, which was again it was another step up the ladder. I felt, because it was starting to show that I'm getting amongst it well enough to win a meeting.
Well, unfortunately, as you mentioned, the crowds at Bradford really weren't that good that year. And unfortunately, it was shut down at the end of the season, and another enforced move, this time to the Midlands at Wolverhampton for 1998.
Yeah, it was quite an unexpected move, really, because it wasn't a track, not that I didn't, I loved riding there, but it wasn't a track in the past that I'd had brilliant meetings at. However, when I went there with Bradford in 97, I had some good meetings there, so kind of changed my outlook on the place. And when Bradford had shut, Chris Van Stratton come straight up with a good offer, and the fact that he wanted me to ride there, and it was quite an unexpected move there, but it was a thoroughly enjoyable one.
Yeah, the Wolverhampton circuit is probably as different as chalk and cheese to say Exeter and Bradford.
Yeah, that's it. I started off. A little bit mediocre around there, but certainly by midway and at the end, certainly the end of the season, I was getting as good a scores as anyone around there. So, a lot of people say to me, oh, it was a bad move for you and everything. It certainly wasn't a bad move for me, because Chris Van Stratton was equally as good a promoter as anyone I've ridden for. The track is a bit tricky, but
an enjoyable one to ride. I think the fact was that 98 just wasn't a year for me personally, and there was only one thing, and one thing that was down to is myself. So, you know, although I didn't have a good year, it's not the fact that I didn't enjoy it Wolverhampton, because I did.
As you say, it wasn't a particularly good year, especially on the individual front, because unfortunately you missed out on a place in the following year's Grand Prix series.
Yeah, unfortunately, yeah, I did, but, you know, years gone by, some riders have qualified through change of rules, if you like, and I've always been a little bit unlucky on the other way, where change of rules have trying to kept me out of it. It was unfortunate, but again, I had my six meetings like everyone else in the Grand Prix to do what I had to do, and I didn't do it. So you got to face facts no matter what rules, regulations. If you don't come up with the goods, then you have to go and qualify.
Well, again, we were unable to bring you any action of Mark at his home track for a second year in a row, no one operating at Monmore Green in 98, but we did catch him down at Wimborne Road. Take a look at heat number 14.
Well, he's in second place, but here comes Boycie on the inside, and he's found a way through into second place. Can he stay there? Mark Lauren, well, everyone knows what he's capable of at Wimborne Road, and well, he's all over the Paul Pair trying to find a way past as Craig Boyce, when he takes the lead on the inside, Mark Lemon on the outer. Lauren, well, we saw these three in an earlier race and saw what happened when Mark Lemon came down, but he's holding his line at the moment. He still leads the way, and Mark Lauren, well, he's going out very wide. Craig Boyce, well, he's on that inside line, and well, he's come back through into second place. Another absolutely thrilling race down here at Paul, as Mark Lemon leads the way from Boyce in second place. Mark Lauren now is switching lines to the inside to try and find a way past Boycie, but he shuts the door on him. Yes, would be Jensen. Well, he hasn't had a look in heat number 14, and this could be a match winning 5-1 in heat number 14, as Mark Lemon wins the race. Second place goes to Boyce, third spot only to the...
Okay, so it's hardly a vintage year for Mark. Now let's go and rejoin him again back with Bryn Williams.
Well, the end of the 1998 season at Wolverhampton, and again, you were on the move in the winter, and a move to the south coast, down to the Sunshine Pool.
Yeah, it was unfortunate. Chris Van Straten felt again he had to make changes with Wolverhampton not being successful again. So, you know, no hard feelings. The fact that they had the Carsons on contract and I was a lone rider, that unfortunately one of the changes was me, you know. So, like I say, no hard feelings, but with Paul coming under new promotion coming in, and always again a track I've enjoyed riding, and I knew Matt Ford quite well anyway before the move down there, ended up signing a contract and going down to ride Paul.
Yeah, it's fair to say that Paul had been in the doldrums the year before, but I mean 1999 turned out to be a season to remember.
Yeah, it was fantastic, you know, brilliant crowds, good promotion, good team. Nothing else you can ask for, really. It was it was very enjoyable.
Unfortunately, a couple of injuries towards the end of the season dented your title hopes, but you were still in with a chance of winning that title right up to that very last meeting of the season at King's Lynn.
Yeah, it was unfortunate. I think it didn't help, obviously, losing Scott Nichols. He's had a fantastic year and upped his average a lot. And he wasn't easy to replace, you know, to get someone as determined as him wasn't easy. And then, of course, Peterborough losing Magnus Zetterström, again, very difficult person to replace when he's on that sort of average and at reserve. So what can you say, you know, we were so near yet so far away, you know, second. We'd have been happy with that at the start of the year, I think anyone would, but it's just a shame you go from being winner to first loser, you know. It's just the way it goes. And at King's Lynn, we knew it was up against it. They didn't do us any favours, obviously. You didn't expect them to. And ended up in a disappointment. But on the other end, you know, a good year for us all down there, and including the crowd, I think, enjoyed it all. Certainly the crowd's gone up. And promotion had a good year, hopefully. And on a personal front, not only was it a good team to ride for, it was a good track, and everything went well.
From Israel, well, it most certainly did. We'll take a look at Mark in action down at Wimborne Road with his teammate Gary Havelock. rejoining Javi, of course, so successful in 97 at Bradford, and where he's out against one of his former teammates from that league race team, Joe Screen, who's in yellow and black, and another former teammate, Chris Louie, comes out in white as a replacement for Sam Emelianenko. Paul V. Hull, heat number 13.
13 then is about to get underway, and out of the start it is pretty even, and with Chris Louie's made a good start, Gary Havelock is trying to come through on the inside, Mark Lauren, well, he's found a way past Joe Screen, but it is Chris Louie who leads the way. But watch here for Lauren, who's coming around the outside of Chris Louie, is he? It's very tight indeed as they start the second lap, as Chris Louie, well, he's racing on the inside line. Here comes Mark Lauren, he favours the outside, and he's come through in the first place in fantastic style. He was at the back as they, out of the start, but he's moved through in the first place now. Chris Louie in second, Gary Havelock in third, Joe Screen, well, he's the rider at the back, as Mark Lauren, well, he's heading towards a hat-trick of victories, perhaps, as Joe Screen, well, now he's finding a way past Gary Havelock on the inside. What a great race this is in heat number 13 between these four English riders, as Mark Lauren, well, he still leads away. Havi, well, he's fought back again into third place. It's a heat advantage for Paul as it stands at the moment. Chris Louie in second place, Gary Havelock in third. Out in front it is Mark Lauren as they come and take the checkered flag. Luremski wins it. Second place goes to Louie. Third spot to Havelock. Joe Screen, the rider at the back. Look, what a great race that was. 60.1, that was Mark's winning time. The ZX1 Pirates went on to win that match pretty convincingly. They're well in front in the Elite League fixture here against Oxford. Let's join Mark in heat number 11 with Magnus Sederstrom against heat Todd Wiltshire and Jan Stegman.
Underway, can Paul sew the match up in this one? And well, in fact, it doesn't look like it at the moment, because of the Oxford pair, well, they're on a 5-1 as Todd Wiltshire leads the way from Magnus Sederstrom, or from Jan Stegman in second place. Here comes Sederstrom around the outside. Mark Lauren, well, he's at the back. That's a big surprise. Here comes Sederstrom, though. He's come through in the third place. Well, in fact, he's now come through in the first. Brilliant riding there by Zorro. He leads the way from Todd Wiltshire in second place. Mark Lauren, well, he's now finding a way past Jens Stegman on the inside. What brilliant speedway action we've got here in heat number 11. Todd Wiltshire, well, he's now in second place. It was a 5-1 for Oxford, but now it's a 4-2 for Paul. And, well, can Mark Lauren find a way past Todd Wiltshire? No, he cannot at the moment, as they start the final lap. Exciting action. And in fact, now Mark has come through in the second place. Well, what brilliant speedway racing by the two ZX1 Pirates. Magnus Sederstrom, he's going to score his first victory of the night. And Mark Lauren, well, he's going to join him for a 5-1 to sew the match up. Todd Wiltshire only gets a point in third. Jan Stegman at the back. Brilliant action here this evening. 60.1. That was Magnus's winning time. And, well, just listen to the reception for the pair of these riders. Really was brilliant speedway racing. Mark Lauren and Magnus Sederstrom coming through into first and second. Oh, and now we see Mark in action in the Speedway Star Knockout Cup final. First leg against Peterborough. Three races remaining. The scores are level. Paul, they definitely need some heat advantages. Mark out with Havi against Jason Crump and Ryan Sullivan.
He's underway and out of the gate. Well, it is Gary Havelock from the inside. He hasn't made any starts so far this evening, but he's leading heat number 13 from Jason Crump in second place. Mark Lauren in third, and Ronnie Coyne leads it back. Here comes Luremski on the inside of Crump as they come in to start the second lap. Is it going to be a 5-1 for Paul? Well, not at the moment, because Jason Crump, he's still holding on to second place. The ZX1 Pirates, well, they've not had a 5-1 all evening, and it doesn't look like they're going to get one in heat number 13. Jason Crump spinning the Paul pairing. And, well, Javi must be careful, because Jason Crump, well, he may be able to find a way past, as Mark Lauren still attempts to get the better of Jason himself. Ronnie Coyle, he's getting a great view of all the action at the back. Here comes Mark once more on the inside with a lap to go. It is still Gary Havelock who leads the way, very close indeed between the three riders out in front. But Javi it is who still leads. Crump attempting to find a way past on the outside. Mark Lauren, well, he's trying to join his teammate on the inside. And it's going to be a race to the line as they come across it. Gary Havelock gets the win, and that's very, very close indeed. Who got up into second place? Javi, well, he just gets the victory. And well, it really was an excellent speedway race, certainly the race of the night and one of the races of the season.
Well, it most certainly was, and with the crowd reaction, you can see they were happy with it, the vast majority of them. It was in fact a 5-1 given to Paul. They went on to an 8-point win, but Peterborough, well, they went on to win the trophy and complete the treble, of course. And well, just look at the reception of the atmosphere we had down at Wimborne Road in 99. And well, we return to the Elite League now, and this certainly was one of the races of the season. Gary Havelock and Mark out against Greg Hancock and Billy Hamill, heat number 13. Coventry, other visitors.
Hancock has made a good go from the inside, so Gary Havelock, and he leads away. Mark Long, well, he's missed the start completely, and he's at the back. Billy Hamill, well, he's gone around the outsiders as Mark Long, well, he's found a way passing the second place, but Hamill has come back on the outside. Well, all happened on the first lap. Gary Havelock leads away. Mark Long, well, now is in second place. Hamill, well, he's just back in third. Greg Hancock is getting a great view of all this. He's at the back as Hamill fights back again on the inside. What terrific speed action here we've got in heat number 13. This evening as Gary Havelock, well, he still leads away from Mark Long, who's got out too wide, and Hamill, well, has he come through? No, he has not. Mark Long, who rides his track each week, of course, he knows where the fastest lines are, and he's holding on to second place. But here comes Hamill once more on the inside. The two riders collide. He got very close indeed there, and Billy Hamill has come through in the second place. Gary Havelock still leads away. Here comes Mark Long again on the outside, and he's going to come back through in the second place. Is he? What a brilliant speedway race in heat number 13. Gary Havelock gets the win, and Mark Long, when he gets second place, well, you need to go many a mile to see a better speedway heat than that. And well, that's got the crowd on their feet. Brilliant speedway action in heat number 13 between those two riders in your picture, Greg Billy Hamill.
And well, it most certainly was. Paul went on to a 15-point victory, and when they set up that last day of the season decider at King's Lynn.
He gets the win.
And Mark, we scored a paid maximum in this meeting. Wimborne Road erupting. Now let's go up to the Norfolk Arena.
And well, the bonus point is also on the cards. But what a reception for this pair.
Mark Long. And with the ZX1 Pirates got off to an awful start against Kings Lynn. They trailed by 11 points after seven heats. And well, Mark had a particularly bad start with two falls, almost unheard of anywhere, of course, especially his former track. And well, let's join him in heat number 8. He's out of the golden double tackle substitution brought out by Neil Middleditch, and he's out with Matty Furjan against Robbie Keza and Travis McGowan
during the winter.
And well, one that certainly seems to have caught the imagination of the public. Let's see what happens in heat number 8. Can Loram make it work for him and his side as the racer gets underway? Furjan has made a good start and he leads the way. That's good news for Paul, as he's in lead. He's leading the way from Kessler in second place, and Travis McGowan, he's in third. But watch here for Mark Loram, and he's moved through into third place already. And well, he's right behind Robbie Kessler as well. He comes around the outside of the German as they go down the back straight for the second time, as Matty Furjan, well, he's way out in front. Kessler in second place, but he may not be for much longer, as Loram, well, he switches back brilliantly on the inside, and he moves through into second place now. Furjan, well, he's miles out in front, but no doubt he'll be looking behind to see if his teammate has come through in the second place, and then he will slow things down on the final lap, no doubt, to allow Mark to get the maximum 6 points. It'll be an 8-1 for Paul Furjan when he looks behind, and well, this would in fact just bring it to in 2 points. Paul is staging a great comeback. Furjan, well, he slows down, and Loram comes through to take the victory. 6 points for him and his side, 2 points for Furjan, one to Robbie Kessler, and 8-1 to the visitors then. And that really has put them right back in this meeting. Mark Loram, what a star, 62.2 is winning time, living up to his tagging as the world's best racer. And well, we'll see again as they come out of the start. Watch him, Mark will say he's out of the shot at the moment, but not for very long. As Furjan, well, he made a great start. And well, then it was Mark Loram. It didn't take him long at all to find a way past Travis McGowan. It looked like he may have taken Kessler on the first lap as well, but he bided his time, switched lines around the outside. And well, here he comes. Well, he most certainly did a brilliant ride then by Mark. And well, before this meeting, we did have a few words with some of the people who've been closely involved with him this year. This is what they had to say to Bryn.
Points, his first of the meeting.
With me now is Paul Coke, promoter Matt Ford. And Matt, during the winter when you took over the reins down there, Wimborne Road, I think one of your first targets, and I'm sure you're glad you got him, was Mark Loram.
No, not really. He's a load of pony.
Well, that's what we all think.
Dead serious. Yeah, I think he was top of everybody's shopping list in Paul, whether it had been ourselves or if it had been Mervyn Stewsbury still owning the club. I think he's proved this year undoubtedly that he is the best racer in the world. You know, I think we all, and that's promoters, fans alike, want to see Mark actually perhaps miss the tapes occasionally, although at times it doesn't play well on our hearts. But no, he really is a credit to the club and a credit to the country, and you know, hopefully he can go on and next year prove himself a worthy sort of Grand Prix rider.
Well, a big question, of course, for next year. He's on loan from Exeter, Colin Hill. I presume that you're going to have words with Colin.
Well, I wouldn't have thought Colin would want to come up into this league because of the expenses. So I would certainly like. I mean, it's going to be heartbreaking to tell any one of them that they're not, you know, required next year. And sometimes perhaps you even want to be told by them that they don't want to come back, because, you know, Mike and I aren't really in the, you know, we're not used to having to do this type of thing. But no, I mean, cards on table, Mark Laram is got to be at Poole next year. I think we would be hung, drawn and quartered if we didn't have him back next year. The fans would not be happy at all. And then I'd have to deal with Norrie Allen, of course, as well. But no, he is a target, of course. And I think he's happy there as well. And I mean, another thing is I feel that he genuinely has actually improved at Poole. And, you know, I don't think there was a person in British Speedway that would have said that Mark was an out-and-out number one at the beginning of the year, yet now he's second or third in this country, so yeah, definitely.
Well, with me now is Poole's team manager, Neil Middleditch. Neil, you say what you think. What's it like working with Mark?
Oh, it's brilliant, yeah. He's the...
I said say what you think.
Oh, sorry, OK. Yeah, no, he's brilliant. No, Mark's a great team man. Great, one of the best, if not the best racer, you know, in my opinion. I'm probably a bit biased because he rides for me, but no, he definitely is one of the best.
I mean, it must be brilliant as a team manager, knowing that you've got him there. If you need to use him as a tack sub, doesn't matter whether he misses a gate, he's going to get you points.
That's right, I know. That's the thing with Mark. I mean, if he could gate, he'd be absolutely unbeatable, which he has been. But from the back, he's just phenomenal. He's an absolute legend from the back. And I don't think, you know, I've been around Speedway for 35 years, and I don't think I've seen a racer as dedicated or as keen as Mark.
The trouble is, if he gates, the crowd get annoyed, don't they? Because they don't get their entertainment.
No, that's right. I know they want to see him come from the back, which he does great. But no, it's better for my heart when he makes the start, believe me.
And ideally, you want him back next year with you at Poole. That's if you're team manager, of course, because we just heard from Matt that he reckons you're too colourful for it and you dazzle him.
Yeah, no, because I'm better looking than Matt, you see, that's what it is. But yeah, I've got to have a few chats in the winter with the wife and family and just check it doesn't clash with any business commitments. But yeah, I'd love to be back. I've thoroughly enjoyed the season. I've had a great team. The boys have all been fantastic. So it's been a dream year. It's a dream team. You know, it really is.
And Mark Laram, a dream racer.
Oh, absolutely. The best.
Thanks, Neil.
Okay.
Well, Gary, you're probably better qualified than most to tell us about Mark Laram, because you've ridden with him at Bradford and now you're a skipper down at Poole. I mean, what is he like to work with?
Well, it actually goes a long way further back than that with me and Mark. You know, I probably met Mark when he was about 8 years old or something, when we rode junior grass track together, and his family and my family got quite close, and we used to he'd come up to our house a few times, and we knew each other really well. We sort of lost touch a bit when he was, you know, I think he packed in the grass track for a while when he started Speedway, but when he, you know, I always talked to him and something, but when he came to Bradford, obviously spent a long time together, and then this year, and you know, what can you say about Mark Laram? I mean, it hasn't already been said, you know, he's really is the ultimate racer, and you know, I think this year, especially more than anything, he's actually gone up a level. His racing's gone up a level, and he's actually become world class now. I mean, he did not last season, the year before, he started it, and he'd done well in the GPs, and he actually won one of the GPs. But this year, he's just been phenomenal. You know, you go any track, any conditions.
Well, speaking as a rider who's ridden against Mark now, presumably when he's behind you, you just haven't got a clue what he's going to do, whether he's going to try and overtake you on the outside or the inside, and you must be worrying all the time.
Yeah, well, that's a good thing about this year, that he's in our team. You know, I'd rather have him in my team than be riding against him. He's just phenomenal, and you know, the fans up and down the country see it week in, week out. You know, the Poole fans are spoiled, because, and the Bradford fans before them, because they used to get it every week. And, you know, I just hope we can keep this going now and actually go on to, you know, be right up the top and maybe be world champion. He's certainly got the ability. And I think this year he's got the aptitude and the quality. If he can carry this on, you know, there isn't no reason why he can't be world champion. You know, he's as good, if not better, than Golub and Ricardson and all them lot. So, you know, he just needs to get back in the GPs and then perform regularly.
Well, it certainly has come down. And well, have he joined Mark for the last race of their Elite League campaign? And well, the Paul fans, you may wish to look away at this stage.
It is Ricardson off gate number three. We've got Mark Lorimer from the outside. It is Lee Adams. So the parts will be in the mouths of the Paul supporters. Their season, the destination of the Elite League title, comes down to this one final race. Can Gary Havelock and Mark Lorham provide them with the Elite League title? We're soon going to find out. Will Tony Ricardson and Lee Adams prevent them? Heat number 15, when it gets underway, out of the start it is Ricardson in fact, and Lee Adams are in first and second. Mark Lorham is in third, and Gary Havelock leads at the back. So it looks as if the Elite League title is going to go to Peterborough this evening, as Lee Adams leads the way in from Tony Ricardson. Here comes Mark Lorham, in fact, on the inside of Tony Ricardson, the world champion. He's come through in the second place, and well, that's amazing, as Lee Adams leads the way. Mark Lorham, when he was passed by Tony in heat number 13, but he gets his revenge in heat number 15, but it doesn't look as if it's going to be enough. Six laps, of course, the final race, but it is Lee Adams who leads from Mark Lorham in second place. Tony Ricardson only back in third. Gary Havelock, well, one rider out to be last. Unfortunately, it is heavy in this final heat. As they go down the back straight for the fourth time, Lee Adams looks like he's going to clinch his third consecutive race win, as he leads away from Lorham in second place, Tony Ricardson in third, Gary Havelock, well, he's still at the back, an engine failure of course for Lee, and well, that would mean we'd have a draw and give the title to Paul, so it's still imperative that the riders race to the chequered flag as they start the final lap, and it is Lee Adams who's out in front then from Mark Lorham in second place, Tony Ricardson in third, Gary Havelock, well, he's still at the back. It looks as if Lee's going to win the going to get the victory, which gives the title to Peterborough, as he takes the chequered flag first ahead of Mark Lorham. Third spot goes to Tony Ricardson. Gary Havelock at the back, 91.5 the winning time, and Lee Adams it is who's the victor in the final race, a 4-2 for the home side. So Paul just unable to lift the title then, but it really has been a very successful season, 1999 for Paul and Mark in particular. And well, now let's go back and rejoin the main man.
A 4-point lead. It looked like it was going to be them that claimed the Elite League title, but it was not to be. A tremendous match, so the fans were there giving both sets of riders a tremendous reception.
Well, 1999 Mark on the individual front, despite not being in the Grand Prix series, you actually finished riding in five out of the six meetings as a wild card, and you had a pretty impressive record, fifth in the world.
Yeah, it was good. It was a shame I didn't get in the first one as a wild card, but you know, as soon as I was put in the second one at Sweden, I knew I had to impress to carry on, to have any chance to be selected. Obviously winning Sweden was pretty good, and I didn't, at the start of the meeting, it wasn't looking like it was going to be possible to win it, but in the end, you know, after the rain, it made the track a little bit tricky, and I'd come into my own then and end up winning it, which put me in good stead for the rest of them. And then obviously the Grand Prix was, the British final was a very good day. Again, going on to win it. And a good meeting for any English rider to win. And after that, what do we have?
Well, it was Big Gosh and Boyan's good performances there. And of course, as well as doing the Grand Prix themselves, as you said, the British final, and you had to go through the qualifying rounds for 2000.
Yeah, it was a good season, winning the overseas final. Voyens had a good Grand Prix final. Again, in Bydgoszcz, was a bit of a shame, the incident that happened there. But, you know, again, good to make an A final. And looking at it in hindsight, fifth place with only doing five rounds and making a complete cock-up of Wroclaw. You know, that if I could have done a little bit better there, then you know, I'd have been on the rostrum. It would have been tremendous.
Fifth in the world, but as I said, through those qualifying rounds,
and into the Grand Prix Challenge. You touched upon it earlier in this tape about that Grand Prix Challenge, but it's one meeting that no one as a rider looks forward to, is it?
No, especially as, you know, it's at the end of the season and I had a long, busy year and a successful year, but I resented being there. But at the end of the day, I didn't complain, you know. They told me I had to go there and qualify. I had to qualify, you know, but end of the season, you know, your enthusiasm's down. You're not riding quite so good. You know, I always do after the last Grand Prix that the rest of the season's a bit of a struggle to get motivated and put quite, you know, the effort in you have done all year. So that's the wrong time to have such an, well, one of the most important meetings of my career, and stressed myself out of it a little bit, made real hard work of it, but it's done now and I'm there, so thank God.
Yeah, all came good in the end.
That's it, yeah. Like I say, it's not the best track for me anyway, and I had 8 races to get there, and I'd used every single one of them, so used a few lives up a few times, but luckily I'm there. It would have been a shame not to be.
Much better afternoon.
Oh, well, it most certainly would have been. Now let's take a look at some of the action from those meetings. Mark just mentioned this, the British final. You see plenty of support for Chris Lew. Remember that epic he had with Mark a couple of years ago? They come together here in heat number 9. Mark's had 2 emphatic race victories. Our thanks to JSD Videos for this footage.
All 4 settle in for 9, green lights on, a clean break, and Lauren makes a super start. Louis gets it, Lauren gets a corner first, but Louis got round the edge of Lauren, and Louis leads the back to that one. Lauren cuts back for the inside, nipping tuck between these two, going into that company. Ben Norris in third with Sean Tate in the back as Louis has got the speed round the outside line. Louis then for Lauren. It's Norris in third with Tate at the back as they make their way in their back straight. And then Lauren's got a line, he's pegged back to the ground. Louis going down that back straight, these two pulling away then for Norris. Lauren goes wide, Louis goes wide. Now Lauren cuts back for the inside, could get back inside Louis this time. There's Louis and Lauren absolutely shoulder to shoulder coming out of that pitch corner. Norris in third with Tate. The back, and now Lauren comes alongside Louis, but Louis has just got the spin on the outside. Louis's gone wide again. Lauren might get through this time. Now Louis gets tremendous drive coming out of that company bend, and now Lauren goes right round the outside of the pitch corner. Nip and tuck between these two as Louis and Lauren are right between them going into last corner. Louis has got to ride the inside. Lauren might come right round the outside. Louis has took Lauren right, and Lauren, I think it is just Lauren. I'm sure that is just Mark Lauren. Louis came late, but Lauren had got tremendous drive around the outside. It wasn't quite so good as that roll up, but my word, it was a cracking race between those two.
And well, it most certainly was. And well, we'll take another look at the action replay.
Of the highest order, and I think Mark Lauren has just snapped on the line. We'll leave it for Mark Postlewaite, but I think Lauren could well be unbeaten.
My goodness me, heat number 9, and what a cracking race that was. The winner, in red, Mark Lauren.
And well, indeed, Mark did just get the victory.
And Mark's winning time, 61.8 seconds.
And well, Mark won his fourth ride as well, and he came into heat number 19, just needing 1 point to take the title for the second time in 3 years.
Dugard 3, Lauren Gate number 4, looking to become British champion. Only a disaster can stop him in heat number 19. Green lights on. A clean break, and Lauren's made a good game before. Getting bit slow going into that first corner. Dugard leads in that corner. Lauren works his way from the second. Now he drops back to third. In fact, as a rider in blue going, Havelock goes on the inside, and they're whipping up Mark Lauren between them. Lauren almost drops to last there. It's Carl Stone, you almost caught inside Lauren. And it's Havelock who shows for Dugard. These two really battling it out there. They're desperate for points, particularly in the case of Havelock. Lauren gets on the inside Dugard to move through in the second place. Now he goes one, and Dugard cuts back inside him. It's this Havelock who shows in for Lauren. Dugard in third, Stone here getting towed off the back, and now Lauren having to go at his poor teammate Gavin Havelock, trying to get through on the inside or really settle for a safe second place. He also knows that Havelock needs points to get into that top 7. As Havelock shows in for Lauren, it's Dugard in third, Stone in the back as they make their way into that pitch. I think Lauren has settled for a safe second place. He's looked left, he's looked right, he knows he's got no danger. He knows that Havelock needs the points as well. Dugard comes late, but Lauren gets a safe second. As Havelock gets a win, will not be enough points for him. Second Mark Lauren, who is British champion in 1999, Third place Martin Dugard had looked for a moment if things could go all wrong there for Mark Lauren, because he knew a third place was good enough. For a long time he was only in third place, but Carl Stoner up his exhaust pipe. I think once he got past Dugard with a swift move on that third lap, he realised second place was enough. He knew he hadn't got too much danger. He knew that Havelock, his teammate at Poole, needed the points. And I think Mark Lauren settled for a safe second place. He's desperate to get back in the Grand Prix, and he's put in a tremendous performance to become British champion here at Coventry this afternoon.
Third place, Chris Lewis.
Yeah, well, we've seen this shot before, not too long ago, of course. Chris Lewis finished third, Joe Screen second on this occasion. Mark the winner once more. And the champagne out. Once again, Mark will have to get used to performing this particular ritual in 1999. And also the Paul supporters are going to have to get used to this sort of ritual as well. Over the next 3 weeks, it really was a golden period in Mark's career, winning his first major title of the year. And we're being applauded around Wimborne Road, showing off the trophy, as we say. And within the following week, it was on to Linköping for the Swedish Grand Prix. And let's see what happened there. And well, we did in fact catch up with the action from the Swedish Grand Prix down at Eastbourne. And well, we've seen him a few times.
Oh, what? Here we are in the pits watching Telly. No, just about to show the A final for the Swedish Grand Prix. Because Mark Lauren hasn't seen it.
I should have retired after this race on a high note.
And well, I don't know about that, Mark, but take a look at the action anyway.
Goes from gate three, and on the outside is Lee Adams, British champion Mark Lauren. Been a purple patch for him for the last 12 days or so. The tape's about to go up. The starting marshal goes away. Away they go on the inside, but from gate two, Jimmy Nielsen picks it up. Mark Lauren well placed now in gate three to pick it up, but losing ground there as through on the inside goes Rickardson and shuts the gate on Lauren. But Jimmy Nielsen is doing another of his armchair rides out front. He's going to be challenged by Rickardson, who would take him wide here, but Nielsen cuts back well. Good position, but look at Mark Lauren as he goes up the outside to squeeze out Rickardson in second place. And now mount a challenge on Jimmy Nielsen. Could this be glory for the man from Poole as he goes down this straight? Coming across well is Jimmy Nielsen to shut him out. Mark Lauren is not done. This is tremendous stuff.
My heart says Mark Lauren, but of course, looking at this, Jimmy Nielsen's under control at the moment. Mark trying so hard. I mean, he's almost there.
Look at Lauren, he's got the inside, he takes it through. Nielsen comes back, it's Lauren and Nielsen. Nielsen and Lauren, tremendous speedway here. What a ride by Mark Lauren. He's going to get glory. Can he hold Nielsen off? Mark Lauren, a tremendous ride. The Brit has won it. Mark Lauren takes the Swedish Grand Prix. The wild card has triumphed. The Brit has triumphed. Jimmy Nielsen is squeezed out. The Swedes are dumbfounded. And what a ride by our very own Mark Lauren, British champion and now Swedish Grand Prix champion. And Peter Collins, that man there, Jimmy Nielsen, must be dumbfounded.
Yeah, well, what a brilliant race victory that was for Mark.
Is that the first time you've seen it?
Yeah, that's it, the first time now. And I had a chance to go and borrow a video to watch.
So what do you think?
Yeah, it was good. Obviously, it was the right outcome in the end. And I think the last couple of laps, I seemed to get going. And obviously done enough to win it, which is good enough, really.
It looked like damn hard work, though, to come back from there.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you wouldn't put money on it happening, really, not in that sort of class of riders, you know, in that sort of field position. But it's good that I did, because obviously it showed everyone that said to me, it's one of the best races I've seen. So, you know, I don't mind doing it and winning from behind, as long as I get the right result, but it goes against you.
You must have been elated, though, when you won.
Yeah, I was. It took a little while to settle in, to be honest with you, but it was back down to earth, straight in the van and drive to Poland, so I hadn't really done well.
I don't know, Jonathan, it's such a hard life for a speedway rider, isn't it?
Oh, well, it certainly is, and with this coming up, is typical of the reaction to that race.
How would you think the success of Mark Laram in the Swedish Grand Prix is going to fire up the rest of the British lads?
Well, of course, it must encourage them, because that was a sort of a, what I would say, one of the most fantastic races I think I have ever seen. And Mark thoroughly deserved it, because up until the middle of the meeting, in the early part of the meeting, poor Mark, it was getting very slick and dry, and Mark had run last in his previous race, and he had one more race to prove himself. Unfortunately, the rain came, and the track changed considerably, and once there was a bit of dirt there, what a difference he was. He was an absolute revelation, and it just proves a point that if there's a track with dirt on, Mark must be one of the best entertainers in the country.
Well, once more it's back to Wimborne Road, and we're again something rather different before the meeting to salute the new Swedish Grand Prix champion. And well, here he comes round, you can see. Rather slower mode of transport than he's used to. And well, there's going to be a presentation. Clive Fisher, the centre green presenter, master of ceremonies. And well, let's listen what he's got to say.
Which please welcome Norrie Allen, ladies and gentlemen. Come on, Norrie. You may not have been brought to the forefront. I suppose it's very difficult to see races though when you're a mechanic. Did you have a chance to see much over there in Sweden?
Not a thing.
Not a thing?
Real disappointed. He never got a track record.
Well, we've got a little surprise for you, Norrie. I didn't know if you knew anything about this, but Matt Ford decided you weren't going to be left out. Matt, what have you got for the Supremo?
We have trouble with Norrie every week. Track conditions, because God only knows what. So we've decided to get him some slippers. He's had 9 years with Ivan Major, and now Mark Laram, and a pipe as well. And we feel it's time that Norrie packed in. And we've also got him a bottle. Just say thanks very much, Norrie.
Right,
and behind every good rider, there's a good mechanic and mentor.
Let it go, Norrie!
And so Matt's making that presentation to Norrie. Now he's certainly had a big influence on Mark's career. And well, now Clive's going to have a few words with the main man himself.
It seems a ritual, Mark, but it's a lovely one, if I may say so, to interview yet again. But congratulations, it was superb. How do you feel about it a few days on?
It was excellent. You know, I mean, I'll be honest, you know, I didn't expect to go there and win. I just wanted to put on a good show and get through, the final spot. I was completely over the moon with, and, you know, when I was in a challenging position in the final and all of a sudden found myself threatening for first and just kept going and, you know, ended up winning, which is tremendous.
I was going to say, getting to that final was the biggest incentive, but once you get there, you thought, God, I can win this.
Well, that's right. I mean, I had even less pressure than I would have done if I was in, you know, permanently. It's just seen as a wild card, nothing to lose, and if I go out and enjoy it, and enjoy it I did, and after that rain, when they put a bit more dirt down, obviously it was right up my street.
Up your street. Congratulations, we've got another couple of presentations to you. Clive Tyres, you'd like to step forward. You don't know about this one. We've got a luxury weekend for two breaks in Forestine Hotel, courtesy of the Wessex Hotel, and also two tickets for the Lord of the Dance and the BIC. So, Mark, with your leisure, take a break, speak over, when you get a chance. Ladies and gentlemen, Mark Laram and Clive Tyres.
Oh, a nice break coming up for Mark. He's thoroughly deserved it after this season, of course. And now we've got another one from Coke Malta promoter Mike Golden.
A nice washer dryer. Tell us about this, Mike.
Well, we actually heard from Norrie that Mark and his partner's washing machine was packing up. But, you know, first-hand experience, after last Wednesday, he left his dirty kit in the clubhouse and I had to take it home and my wife had to do the washing. And then I took it out to Sweden to make sure he had a dry set of Kevlars to wear to win that A final. So on behalf of Full Speedway, we'd like to present him with a new washer dryer.
Well, it's certainly an unusual presentation, but Mark thoroughly deserved it, no doubt. And we'll now rejoin Bryn, and he's talking with Mark's right-hand man, Norrie Allen.
Well, Norrie, you've been involved with Speedway for an awful long time. I mean, how did you first get involved?
Just as a kid in Edinburgh. Just went to the local Speedway, taken there by my parents, and just always been involved with it.
Yeah, you started as a spectator. You had a few second halves a few years ago, but then
you got involved in the backroom scene, as it were.
Yeah, I got involved, done second halves, not very successful, and then I got a chance to go and work for Ivan Major, and then just went from there, worked for him for 9 years.
I mean, that must have been a marvellous experience for you.
Yeah, excellent guy to work for, complete professional. Yeah, I can't speak highly enough of him.
Well, obviously when Ivan's career finished, you moved on. Tell us how you first got involved with Mark.
I was actually doing the bar up at Peterborough, because I had a couple of pubs in Bristol then, and I knew Peter Oakes, and he had just taken over Peterborough Speedway, and he wanted somebody to do the bar. So went up there, I'd done it every week, and, you know, Mark used to ride there occasionally, and just got talking in the bar and said could maybe help him with under 21, and really that's how it started.
So the start of a long and happy relationship was over a pint?
Yeah, really, you know, just having a beer and just talking about Speedway, and, you know, Mark's always been an incredible talent, but just maybe lacked a little bit of being put in the right direction.
So, I mean, that is basically your job, and also you look after his bikes.
Yeah, do all the bikes and, you know, just organise contracts and, you know, just doing deals and transporting everything around Europe and, yeah, from, sorry, March to November, and then, you know, have a holiday in the winter.
So you say you transport Mark here, there and everywhere, but sometimes little birdie tells me that you forget him.
Yeah, run away to Denmark and I stopped to get a coffee, he was asleep, and I come out with coffee, carried on up the road, and 3 hours later I stopped, hopefully for him to take over a bit of driving, looked in the back, he wasn't there.
He was stuck. He'd gone out to the gents, as it were, at the services. And
he seen the van drive off, and he thought, oh, it's not a problem, I'll just ring the mobile, which he had switched off, and I carried on my merry way.
So he forgave you for that, and you're carrying on with him, and hopefully for many years to come.
Well, yeah, as long as Mark's happy, we'll only ever do anything on a year-to-year basis, and as long as he's happy with what I'm doing, and, you know, I'm definitely happy with what he's doing. He's had a great year this year. Hopefully it'll continue in the year 2000.
Well, let's just talk about Mark and his personal life. Has he got any annoying habits?
Yeah, he just sometimes you say things to him and, you know, we've got to do this for next week, and he just completely forgets about it.
So he's not best organised, and that's where you come in.
Yeah, I think it's most likely, you know, with the fixture list, like this year he's done 120 meetings, and it's very hard for the rider to, you know, concentrate on his riding and trying to organise all these meetings and, you know, just really working out the year's calendar, and which I think we do quite successfully for the amount of meetings that he does, and, you know, there's just the two of us doing it, so we take on quite a heavy schedule.
And what do you like about Mark as a racer?
He's very exciting. Personally, I would rather just see him making 5 starts in the night and doing it the easy way. But, you know, I think that's where why he's so popular is he is an exciting rider, and he tries so hard, and you can't knock the effort he puts in. Even if he has a bad night, you can't come away and say, oh, you never tried, or, you know, you were a waste of time, because, you know, he has always put the effort in.
And often, especially this year, in 1999, he's had to battle against illness as well.
Yeah, he got that hepatitis when he was in Mexico, and, you know, that really knocked the stuffing out of him. And I know that when he went to the doctors, he come back and he had said to the doctor, you know, how long do you think I'll be off from riding, how many weeks? And the doctor had said to him, oh, you're talking months. And that was a bit of shock for the system. But I think looking back on it, it was maybe a good thing.
In what way?
Well, he realised that, you know, he could be out of the Speedway game and his earnings for X amount of months. And then, you know, all of a sudden I think he maybe woke up and said, I've got to go about this in a different way.
Well, let's have a look at the future now. He's qualified as of right for the Grand Prix Series in the year 2000, after being a wild card for most of 1999. And certainly most people say he's got the ability to go on and win the World Championship.
Oh, I think he has. He's got every chance, as much as anybody else. I think he's proved this year that, you know, as a wild card, he's went out there, he started at the beginning of the meeting, and he's out of the five Grand Prix, he's been in three A finals, won one, second and one, and if he can continue that and be as keen as he has been in 99, I think the sky's the limit.
And hopefully you'll be at his side.
Definitely.
Well, Norrie was definitely at Mark's side the week after the Swedish Grand Prix success for the overseas final at his Old Track, the Norfolk Arena, of course, and 5 years since he won the Commonwealth title here. Could he add the overseas final, four wins out of four, this heat number 18?
There's Josh Larson there on the outside, the Californian Sizemore, who has predictably and pardonably found it a pretty rugged going out there this afternoon. We'll watch Laram surely. Just four laps away. He's got time to look across to see if there's any danger from the outside. There is not. He is away. And providing the machinery keeps going, there surely is nothing to stop this man in front, Mark Laram, from adding the overseas championship to the titles he has already won this year. And is turning out to be, well, his year. Mark Laram, 28 years old. Previously has ridden in two overseas finals. His best performance thus far is ninth in 1994. It's a bit of a mystery why he's only had so few overseas finals, but there he is there. Currently in the best form of his career. Wild card in the Grand Prix in shopping, earned him another Grand Prix place next month in Poland. And prior to his Swedish success, he won the British final at Coventry with 14 points. It's his second national title. This would be and is going to be a unique hat-trick of titles in high summer. And the pool contingents have made the long cross-country trip from the Dorset coast, the Diamond Ring area of the south coast, right across to King's Lynn. And, well, they've been well rewarded. Their man, Mark Laram, has delivered the goods.
Well, certainly he did. And, well, then he was at the Intercontinental Final on the World Championship trail, and well, he did enough to qualify for the Grand Prix Challenge. But let's take a look at Mark in action in Lonigo, Italy.
It must be said from Laram, he hasn't won it from the starts. He's had to work hard from the back. He's done it with style and amazing grace. Then we've got Mark.
And as we heard earlier from Mark, he did not enjoy this meeting one bit, and really was struggling throughout it. Gary Havelock, well, he's already gone out. This is heat number 16. Mark, he's in blue against Cole Stonehill, Robert Dados, and Yasuk Golub. Two riders go through, two go out.
Oh, that's a lovely start from Stonehill. Oh, that's a beauty. He's away from the inside, in red. And in second place, it's Laram. Laram under pressure from Golub. Golub now bursting past Mark Laram. Come on, Laramski, you cannot stay there. You've got to get up. And it's Stonehill in front. And what? The Workington lads are loving this. The lad is doing them fine. Let him go. And he's got Mark Laram. Wouldn't it be a sensation if Stoney goes forward and Laramski goes out? But Laramski has got different ideas. He's got Golub in his sights. He's only got two laps to get up. In last place, it's Dados. He's not out of contention. Now, here comes Laram. And this is always a wonderful sight. Swings back down the inside. Oh, that's pretty. Once again, that was pretty to watch. Looked like he'd overcooked. Swung back down the inside into second place. St. George is rampant. The England pair in front, and now Laram going around hard around the outside of Stonehill. Stonehill unaware of all the drama going on behind. And I think this was caught cold. I didn't realise it was Mark Laram. And Laram has ridden an absolute firecracker. Laram has come from third
Well, he certainly did. That was a fantastic race win by Mark. And well, he eventually finished in sixth place in Lonigo to make it through to the Grand Prix Series next year. And well, of course, the other great success story of this meeting was Cole Stonehewer. There are the Poole fans and Workington fans saluting Stoney. But now let's go back and rejoin Mark with Bryn.
Really waving.
Well, over the years, of course, you've been a regular choice for England Test teams, and you've enjoyed a little bit of success by finishing second in a World Pairs final with your old friend, Chris Lewy.
Yeah, it was nice to ride with him for a change, again, rather than against him. It was a good year for us in Bydgoszcz. The track was quite, you know, quite deep, and we had a good day. You know, finishing second in them sort of means good because you're up against, well, a Grand Prix field, basically. And other than that, I think, basically, unfortunately, the only other success I think we've had with England was, I think, finishing third at Cumla in the World Team Cup.
Yeah, but things begin to come good, albeit the Australians seem to be the dominant force at the moment, but England on the up.
Yeah, I mean, we'll get our turn, you know, it's, it sort of goes around and comes around. It was the Danes a few years ago, the Americans before that, and probably the English before that, so I think our time's now coming up. So, well, it's about time.
Yeah, and certainly the advent of Speedway on Sky Sports is certainly doing a bit to encourage youngsters to get into the sport. And you featured quite heavily on Sky Sports this year, haven't you?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I'm no one to blow my own trumpet, but, you know, I've just been told that I've been in some good races, and you know, they seem to enjoy, you know, watching me on Sky, and I'm, you know, making the most of the coverage I'm getting. I'm getting some good coverage, and I'm not, certainly don't think I'm doing Speedway any harm. And Sky as a whole is definitely lifting the profile of Speedway in general everyday life, which is, you know, I'm 28 now, and you know, it would nice to be think that if it takes another step like it has this year, next year, then, you know, sooner or later we're going to be hopefully all earning that little bit more money, and with the sport being on a slightly higher national profile or international profile than it is now, which is, can only be good for the sport and only good for the next generation like Scott Nicholls and all the young riders coming through.
And well, now let's take a look at Mark on international duty. This the World Team Cup final in Kumla, Sweden, which he was talking about, and well, this heat number five.
John Lewy. It's the man in blue we're watching, Mark Loram. Not a particularly good gate, in fact, towards the rear, out in the dirt, and struggling to find a way through. Drives through, cuts through to third spot. Out in front, the American, Greg Hancock, riding superbly. And Mark Loram now looking to make inroads on second place. Certainly more overtaking in this meeting than there was in the individual Speedway World Championship. That was no surprise, though, because conditions there were fairly horrendous. Round the outside goes Mark Loram, pulls down another tearaway visor, and he's out in the dirt. Maybe he can cut back on the inside against the Swede. Well, the Swede knew he was coming, held him off. But the Brit having a go, and he'll cut back on the inside now. One lap to go. Oh, and superb riding by Mark Loram. He fought hard for that second place, and is he going to hang on to it? The Swedes, of course, inspired by the crowd here. Tony Rickardson in white in third place, but it's going to be red, blue, and white.
Louis Kask.
Now we're now 3 years later, and the World Pairs final at Bydgoszcz in Poland. And well, Mark and Chris, they're out against the Australian pair of Craig Boyce and Jason Crump. Enjoy the Polish commentary.
Maszyny startowej, o, tak jak to zrobił zawodnik w kasku niebieskim, Jason Crump i poszedł. Craig Boyce, ale drugi był Mark Loram, trzeci Chris Lewis, czwarty Jason Crump. Wywiozło trochę pod bandek Craiga Boyce'a, ale tak jest, jednak stracił. Tu było parę metrów, większą szybkość miał Mark Loram, zawodnik jeżdżący w polskiej lidze w barwach Avatora Toruń, który to zawodnik godnie zastąpił Pera Jonssona. Prowadzi Mark Loram, na drugiej pozycji jest Chris Lewis, A więc Anglicy w tym momencie zapewniają już sobie dublet, jeżeli tak dalej pójdzie. Trzeci jest Craig Boyce, który po dobrym początku spadł na trzecią pozycję i czwarty jego partner Jason Graham. I spokojnie już Anglicy Mark Loram i Chris Lewis zwiększają przewagę, jak gdyby już bez chęci do walki. Craig Boyce, czwarty jest Jason Graham. Zwycięstwo Anglii nad Australią 5-1.
Oh, a great ride there by Mark, and well, as we heard, Mark and Chris went on to finish runners-up in the World Pairs final this year, and with the team managed a course by John Lewis, and well, we caught up with John, had a big say in Mark's early career, especially when he was Hackney team manager. Bryn tracked him down.
Well, John, you've been associated with Mark for quite a number of years, and it all started way back in 1987 when you were team manager at Hackney, and you plunged him into the British League at the tender age of 16.
That's right, Bryn. You know, remembering back on those days, great days, and yeah, we brought Mark in as one of the reserves in the 1987 team in the British League to start his career off. He had a tremendous season within that league, showing potential, and also, you know, the race, and you could always see that he was going to be a great racer and one of the most exciting riders you could possibly come across, you know, because the experience Cumbrian even before then, when he was in the junior grass tracks, and I used to go along there with Dave Pavitt, myself and Chris and many other riders that have actually made it in the British League, and you could always see from them days that Mark was a born racer. He was always going to make the top in speedway or grass track, whichever one he followed. But from that point onwards, he's always gone forwards from that 1987 season to be, you know, one of the world's most exciting and progressive racers.
Yeah, I mean, certainly the following year, that racing instinct played its part in Hackney, having an all-conquering season in the National League.
Yeah, it did. I think that was, correct me if I'm wrong, that was the year we brought Chris in as well, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And Mark had the season's experience, and yeah, he had a tremendous season throughout that year. Like you said, we all conquering side, we had a tremendous season and won the league that year. So, you know, all those were the makings, and a lot of things were obviously all due to Mark's efforts and the abilities that he's had. And, you know, he's kept those going for many years on.
Yeah, on to Ipswich in the following year, and then you had a spell as England team manager, and you saw him and Chris progress to international level, and that must have given you a lot of satisfaction seeing those two together.
Well, it did, you know, obviously seeing both Mark and Chris at the same time, as they were pals right from the early days of schoolboy grass track racing, mature and come good both at the same time and together. And as you said, Bryn, I at that time, bringing him in, introducing him into the England race jacket was a great honour for me, and also great pleasure, able to watch both of those two making rapid progress as they did along the way, and becoming sort of world stars, as you know, with the experience that they were gaining from riding in the leagues and so on. So it was great, you know. I can't really fault with the progress they've made whatsoever. It's been fantastic.
Well, yourself, you were always renowned as a fast starter. Your son, Chris, is excellent at gating, but neither of you have ever been able to impart that sort of skill to Mark, and perhaps it's just as well, yeah?
Well, as you say, just as well, because the spectators are rewarded with some great races from Mark from the back, in particular, again, this very last season, you know. He's been tremendous with Paul, led the way, some tremendous racing from the back with some top stars, and you know, that is what Mark has become renowned for. Yeah, as you say, that's one of those things, isn't it? You never know why it is, but Mark's always been an out-and-out highly professional rider, well set up, and you would have thought over all these years that perhaps you know, his gating would have got better. But having said that, you know, Bryn, there are times different GPs and different top meetings I have seen, Mark will make one or two electric starts throughout that meeting, but he's never ever done it on a real consistent basis. But if Mark ever did get to that level, then, you know, he would, you know, be unstoppable.
Oh, well, Mark, of course, didn't only ride for British League clubs during his career so far. This in Poland, riding for his Polish side, a Porta Tour run against Polonia Pila, this in 1995. And take a look at the action from this meeting.
Jeszcze Krzysztof Okupski, ale on również już ustawił się przed taśmą. Hans Nielsen, to mówi wszystko. Świetny start Hansa Nielsena, ale Mark Loram po zewnętrznej. Nieprawdopodobna walka na prostej. Świetny start Nielsena, ale kontrował Mark Loram w znakomitym stylu. W tej chwili żużlowiec Zapatora na pierwszym miejscu. Drugi Hans Nielsen na trzecim miejscu. Kolejny torunianin Tomasz Bajewski i atakowany tym razem zaciekle przez Okupskiego. Mark Loram po raz drugi w tym meczu przed Hansem Nielsenem. Ale do zakończenia tej gonitwy jeszcze półtora okrążenia. Na pewno stary lis Hans Nielsen nie zrezygnuje z wydarcia tych trzech punktów zawodnikowi gości. Mark Loram jednak bardzo spokojnie i pewnie prowadzi maszynę.
And so Mark on his way to victory then against Hans. Although his side, where they did lose by 6 points on this occasion, we also caught Mark in Australia, where he's been a frequent visitor over the years. And well, we see Mark in action at Mildura in the Series 500. This race, he's out against Jason Hawkes, Ronnie Corry and Rooney Halter.
And taking evasive action there, Holder almost kissed the boards down in turn two. At the end of the back straight, down in fifth corner, Hawks goes up the inside. No, it's not a Hawks. And allows Holder to go up the inside of him. It's still the Ram of England, Corry of America. Holder is all over. Look at Corry! He got superior traction out of turn two there and had to back off the throttle. And look at Rooney Halter do the big hard yards around the time around. With three more laps to go, halfway distance completed. Rooney Halter continues the successful drive on the outside. This has allowed Mark Loram of England to kick away with it by a couple of bike lengths at the moment over Ronnie Corry of America. Jason Hawkes of Victoria, a last place at the moment. Here comes Holder. Oh, he almost kissed the back wall again. But Mark Loram, he's trying very hard, this pint-sized pocket rocket from Norway. He's got an open door there. Oh, somebody's gone over and hit the fence. Corry almost got up in the second. Halter hit the fence on the exit of turn.
Oh, well, exciting heat, that one. Mark getting the victory. Now let's go back to he and Bryn.
Well, there in shot are just some of the many, many trophies that Mark's won over the years that he's been racing so far. Trophies won not only at Speedway, but also in other disciplines, notably grass track and long track racing. And Mark, you're one of the few riders who've managed to combine all those disciplines together.
Yeah, I mean, I haven't ridden grass track and long track for a few years, really. Main reason because, you know, the dates clash quite a lot, so... So unfortunate, you know, because it was obviously what I started on, and you know, I've always got a passion for it. You know, I've always enjoyed doing it, but there comes a time where the economy side of it to do long track racing and grass track just the figures don't add up. And you know, with me being busy on Speedway now, the grass track has to take a back seat, unfortunately.
But those trophies, I mean, it must be marvellous to look back on them all.
Yeah, I mean, I've won, you know, Bonfire Burn-Ups and, you know, British Master a couple of times. And, you know, they're all good meetings, enjoyable, you know, things to win and beat some good riders in them. So there's no doubt maybe one day I'll go back and do some grass track again. But, you know, for the time being, I just have to look at the trophies.
And well, we'll take a look and see how Mark won a couple of those trophies. This is the 1990 Bonfire Burn-Up Solo Final.
Not let them go until they're satisfied. 10 riders up there on that starting grid. It's going to be very tight down that straight as they speed towards the first turn. It's
so important, of course, to make it first. Let's see just who does. The tapes are up and they speed away. Banks in. Hagen have made good starts into that turn. It's Banks on the inside. Donkey hasn't, though, for the first time. Jeremy Doncaster left there and it's Trevor Banks moving up. Martin Hagen's gone from about second to fifth. Banks leads from Loram. Martin Dugard's up there as well. And Martin Hagen has slipped back in the field. Has he got trouble there, we wonder? So Trevor Banks, it is in first place. Mark Loram's chasing it. Marvin Cox and Martin Dugard in hot pursuit as well. All the top ones are in this one who have been here today. And it's going to be a cracking final. Here comes Loram on the inside of Banks. Can he force his way past Trevor Banks? Loram trying hard. Marvin Cox is up there in third place as well. So Banks holds the lead. Loram is in hot pursuit. Right up there behind Banksy. Trying to drive his way through on the inside. There he goes. Loram moves into the lead and Banks is in trouble. Banks' bike has given up the ghost. That's desperate bad luck for Trevor Banks. So commiserations to him. The race continues. There's Hagen trying to hold off Vince Kinchin at the moment. But it's Loram now in first place. Marvin Cox is there in second ahead of Dugard and Doncaster. Hagen's behind that pack. So Trevor Banks then appear to slow. Loram took his chance. Cox and Dugard in second and third. Doncaster's in fourth. So a bit of a shock for the Aces champion. Marvin Cox and Martin Dugard, they're very similar in style and leather colours. But it's definitely Coxey who's got second place at the moment. But there's a lap to go. Mark Loram is that far away from victory in the burn-up final. Cox second, Dugard's third, ahead of Doncaster, who's holding off Vince Kinchin. Chris Morton back in sixth. So Mark Loram then, round the third and fourth bends for the final time. It's a very tiring afternoon for him, but it's all worthwhile now, despite missing a ride through being asleep. He definitely wasn't asleep in the final one. Wheelies over the line, ahead of Marvin Cox and Martin Dugard. The fireworks go bang to signify Loram's victory. Congratulations to him.
Yeah, well, we certainly knew Mark was a laid-back character, but didn't think he was that laid-back to miss a ride, but say still made the final and winning the title for the first time. Also won it in 1994.
Hagen and Banks with problems. No such worries for the champion, Mark Loram.
And well, now we travel abroad, and this the famed Le Mans circuit in southern France. And this the final. Mark Willys level 1 points with Gerd Riss, Robert Barth, Simon Cross, Kelvin Tatum and Philippe Berger also in this final race. The qualifying points count.
On y voit France, Rouillet 3ème, Marc Loram en 2ème position, France Loram, Cross Loram, Tatoum est enfermé, Tatoum est enfermé. Tatoum est en 3ème position, alors que Riss est 6ème, c'est Simon Cross qui est en tête, et Marc Loram qui pourrait remporter le trophée. Cross Loram, Cross devant Loram, Cross devant Loram, en 3ème position c'est le numéro 2, donc Tatoum, le numéro 2 qui est vite Tatoum, qui sait qu'il doit remonter maintenant. Tatoum qui doit remonter très très vite. Melvin Tatoum, Philippe Hervé qui revient également, c'est déjà bien le Francinat pour Philippe Hervé, le Français, qui est en 5ème position. Hervé qui est devant les deux Allemands, Barth et Riss pour la 5ème place. Hervé qui pourrait remonter pour attraper la 3ème place. Et la victoire de Simon Cross.
Well, it was Crossy that won the big final, but Mark, well, he finished second ahead of Gerd Riss, who retired, you can see, and Mark winning the famous grass track meeting down at southern France. And well, the interview had a few words with him afterwards, thankfully in English.
Prove for you when you were the winner, it was your objective for this year in 1995.
Yeah, well, I knew it was going to be very hard, you know. It's a very difficult meeting with the best riders in the world, and I didn't think I could win it, but things came together, and I didn't know I'd won it till afterwards.
Effectivement, c'était très difficile. Ils tous la même chose. Le niveau était très élevé. Vous avez vu une course très disputée.
And so Mark, as usual, pretty laid back. But the winner, and a very popular winner, by the looks of things as well, down in southern France.
Well, behind every successful Speedway rider is a backup team, and certainly at your side for the last, what, 5-6 years, there's been a certain Norrie Allen.
Yeah, that's it. You know, I met Norrie at a long track meeting way back in 1990 when he was working for Sean Moran, and I guess we always kept in touch, and I used to ring him up even before he worked for me for advice and different things when I was doing my own deals at the time. And when Norrie finished with his pubs, he was, quite financially stable himself, so he decided to come back and, you know, do the Speedway job full-time again, and I was the first one that would, wanted him to work for me straight away. He came to work for me in 95. Norrie's an absolutely tremendous bloke. He's done a lot for me, not just on a Speedway front, but there's been times when, like I said, I had a few years where I stayed stale, didn't take many steps forward that I'd like to have, but, you know, unfortunately I had a lot of problems behind the scenes in a, you know, personal life, which is unfortunate. Everyone has to go through these things in life, but no, I've got a lot to thank Norrie for, not only with what he does at the meetings and in the workshop, but for a few years there he kept me going, and, you know, I think without somebody as, for want of a better word, as stern as Norrie and sort of like a second father to me, I think I could, you know, could have quite possibly at some stages just thrown the towel in and took time out, because it did get a bit difficult at times. And not only has he been a great employee, but a very good friend, and, you know, he kept me going at times where, like a lot of people, if I certainly had been on my own, you know, you might not have seen me about.
Well, you make him sound like an angel, but he must have one or two annoying quirks that you can tell us about while he's not in the room.
Yeah, I mean, he's like everyone. He's no angel, you know. You know, I mean, it's hard. I do lots of meetings in a year, over 100 this year, and we have to spend a lot of time together, but to spend that much time with someone, it's very difficult to get on, and I don't think I'm a really difficult person to get on with, and again, Norrie isn't, you know, and he's got his annoying things, but, you know, I have to put up with them, because I'm sure I'm equally as annoying, and he makes up for his bad ways tenfold, you know, so he leaves his clothes laying around and makes extra housework for everyone, you know, but, you know, like I say, you have to accept these things, and we generally have our differences, and we have words, a little bit of a raised voices at each other. The good thing is, both about me and Norrie, we'll go out the room and come back 5 minutes later and it'll be forgotten about, been said and done and over with, and we can get on with things, which is very important, not just in Speedway, but in life in general.
And he tells us that you've forgiven him for leaving yourself stranded at a foreign service station, that famous story.
Yeah, that's it. That's hilarious when you look back at it. And I wasn't angry. I mean, I saw the funny side of it, even though I was stuck in Belgium for 7 hours, you know, with only a T-shirt and no money and nothing, you know. But I just had to laugh about it, because it was just ironic that I was taking a leak in the bush and off went my van and mobile phone was switched off. I just sat there and laughed. What else can you do, you know? But it's, you know, it's a good partnership. And I know it's going to end one day, but when, you know, when the racing side of it's over and he moves on, if he still wants to and helps another younger rider, certainly the friendship side of it will never end.
Well, as Norrie, as you mentioned earlier, in this tape, a great influence on your career, and two people who've made a lot of sacrifices, well, three people, in fact, are your family, your mum and dad and your sister.
Yeah, that's it. I mean, everyone knows that, 90% of people know that they wouldn't be where they are without their mum and dad, and they took a lot of sacrifices for me when I was younger with my racing. Not only them, but my sister as well, because they couldn't afford to spend a lot of the money they were spending on me, on my sister. So, you know, it's not just about my mum and dad. They were, I wouldn't simply be here now to probably doing what I'm doing without them. But my sister also, she was great. She, you know, she's always been there. I get on great with her now, although she used to beat me up when I was younger, you know, I forgive her for that now. She's turned out to be a great person and a good sister, so there are a lot of people that contribute to it, but obviously your family are first.
Yeah, your dad gets along to see you ride as often as possible, and on occasions your granddad goes along too.
Yeah, my dad tends to get on to me a bit about me riding, but I know it's because he cares. But, you know, it's my granddad, bless him, he goes along now and again. They don't get to see me race as much as they'd like to, really, but that's just the geography of the way the tracks are, and it's a lot of travelling for them. And I think my dad likes to sort of turn to take a back seat now. I suppose he feels he's done his bit early on, which he has. You know, he gave me a great start in life. You know, and no matter what happens, you know, he sometimes thinks I don't appreciate it, but, you know, I certainly do.
Well, with me now is Mark's mum, Vian. Vian, you must be very proud of what Mark's achieved in his speedway career so far.
Very proud. Very, very proud.
I mean, what is it like actually watching him race as a mother?
I don't race much now as I did when he was younger. I think I was worse when he was younger, but now he's older, I tend not to worry so much at all.
So you used to get in a bit of a panic, especially if you fell off, did you?
Oh, God, yeah, definitely. No doubt about that.
Yeah, well, thankfully he's got the skill. He doesn't have that many falls. Many people regard him as perhaps the most exciting racer in the world, and that in itself must make you feel proud.
Oh, it certainly does. I think he's been very fortunate. I think we all have.
And you thoroughly enjoyed watching his career progress?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, so the beginning of what has turned out so far to be a quite superb career, and I'm sure things are going to get even better. And you must be, as his dad, extremely proud of what he's achieved.
Well, I am very proud of what he's achieved. He's a clever lad as well. Mark's one of the type of lads that if he saw me hang a door, well, he wouldn't see me hang a door because I couldn't hang one. But if he saw a tradesman do anything at all, he'd only have to watch it for a short time before he'd be able to almost mimic it. He's quite clever and quite adaptable. He turns his hand to pretty much everything around the house. As you've seen the house he's building, or not building, but doing up. He does a lot of that himself, although he's got two terrific builders working for him and have for years. He does quite a bit himself. He's quite clever like that.
And, well, one abiding memory of you as Mark's dad is probably in the early days, because you used to smoke more cigarettes than me when Mark was out racing, which is quite an achievement.
Yeah, God, I used to smoke... I wouldn't go to a Speedway meeting with an open packet of cigarettes in my pocket. I had to take a full packet to fall back on when I got through the one that was already open. I smoke about 60 a day, and... But he used to go on to me. He hates smoking. Mark always has done ever since he was a kid. And he's on to me and but giving it up. And I eventually gave it up.
But you're obviously very nervous, especially in the early days, watching Mark ride. But nowadays, presumably, you just go there and enjoy it.
Yeah, I don't get a chance to get to many meetings now because of my work commitments. I've retired from the prison service now, but I'm working at Leeds Castle. And I don't get to see many meetings, but with a brilliant coverage, it's on Sky, and that we watch it on Sky. That's terrific. I still wish he could gate like he used to, because he worries me sometimes when he's coming from it. But I know he's completely in control, but well, it's racing, isn't it? And I'd rather see him out the front than somebody chasing him.
Well, he's really still got tremendous potential. Everybody rates him, as I said earlier, as probably the best racer in the world right now. And well, he's in the Grand Prix next year as a right rather than right wild card, and who knows, future world champion.
Oh, I sincerely hope so. If he hadn't missed the early Grand Prix this year, I think he'd have had sufficient points to finish in the top three. I wonder if they made him sort of go in and qualify if he had done. I've got all the confidence in the world that Mark's got it to be a world champion. The only thing is I'd rather have him like he is now, with everyone sort of speaking highly of him. He's a very fair rider. I've heard him years ago when I started. I mean, you know what I'm like at a meeting. I'm terrible. I'm so aggressive. The best thing I could ever done was keep away from Mark in the pits and that. But he's still considered to be a fair rider, and that's the main thing. I've never seen him do anything, that would actually, somebody could say he did it on purpose or was a nasty bit of riding or dirty riding or whatever. He's always been a rider's rider. That's the award I think he's just won at Poole. So, yeah, he's doing all right. He's still a young man.
Well, you mentioned earlier that, like most of us, you've had a few personal problems in your life. You're over that now. And settled life here in Suffolk with your girlfriend.
Yeah, that's right. You know, me and Reese's mum split up some time ago. It was one of those things, you know. I'm not a person that holds grudges, or, you know, I'm a great believer in fate in life, and things are sent to try us, and people get together, people split up. I think it's all mapped out for us in a way that, you know, you'll never really know what's going to happen. And, you know, things have happened. Made a couple of 3 years of my life. The only thing I'm disappointed about, if you like, is that I feel my career suffered. It did. Now it's done and over with, and there's nothing I can do about it. All I can look at it is the positive things of, you know, I've got a great boy in Reese, and get on fine with his mum now, absolutely fine. It's all over and behind us, and now I've got the best thing in my new girlfriend, you know, Jo, or Flo, as I call her. I couldn't ask for a better person, and you know, I'm not an easy bloke to put up with, and my lifestyle certainly isn't easy to put up with, and sometimes it's strenuous for her. But you know, she really is an absolute angel. I couldn't wish to have again fate. I've ended up with a wonderful person, and I just hope that you know, I can get a few years good riding in and make up for them lost years, and also have a good family life as well.
Now, well, now we can see Mark with son Reese. And he's just getting the youngster's bike out of the shed there, as you can see. And, well, I'm sure he's not going to be riding that one. And, well, as you can see, he's all ready to go. And, well, no, that's the bike that he uses, of course. And, well, let's take a look at the style and see if he is a chip off the old block. And, well, he certainly seems to make better starts than what Mark does. He's not quite a leg trailer yet. Certainly showing a fair bit of speed. Well, as you can see, Daddy won't stay off the bikes for very long. Oh. Opening up the throttle now, heading back towards his own little pits. And, well, there you go. And, well, we did have a few words with Loram Jr.
With me now is the next generation of the Loram family, Mark's son, Reese. Reese, tell me, what is your dad really like?
Mad.
You reckon he's mad? Why do you reckon he's mad?
I didn't want him to do Speedway.
You don't want him to do Speedway? I mean, do you want to be a Speedway rider when you grow up?
No.
Why not?
Because you don't win very much.
He doesn't win very much. Don't you think it's a bit of a dangerous sport to be in as well?
Yeah.
Well, what would you rather do then?
Be a stuntman.
Be a stuntman? That's even more dangerous than riding Speedway, isn't it?
Yeah.
But do you quite often go and watch your dad riding Speedway? Do you enjoy going there?
Yeah.
And what do you like about it?
They have crashes.
They have crashes. Well, your dad's been known to have the odd crash or two, but he doesn't crash that often, does he?
No.
Which is good.
Yes.
Now, you've got your own little bike as well, and but you don't want to be a Speedway rider?
No.
No? Not with a dad who's so talented?
No.
No. But so you're going to be a stuntman, and what sort of stunts are you going to do? You're going to drive cars or motorbikes over cars?
Jump 99 cars.
Jump 99 cars. Well, we'll certainly look forward to that in the future. Now, I mean, your dad, does he buy you lots of things?
No.
No? He's a bit tight, is he?
Yes.
All right. And, well, we've got Christmas coming up. Is it going to buy you anything nice for Christmas? Maybe a stunt car?
Yeah.
Right, well, I know that you say your dad's a bit tight, but he's just taken you on holiday to Disneyland, didn't he, in Florida? Did you enjoy that?
Yes.
Did you make him go on all the rides?
No, because he's a wimp.
Eh? He's a wimp, is he? He wouldn't go on any of the scary rides?
No.
No. But you had a good time out there, did you?
Yeah.
And you want to go again?
Yeah.
Well, let's hope he keeps earning lots of money riding Speedway, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, Reese. Well, he's not going to be a Speedway rider. He's going to be a stuntman, which we'll see in a few years' time.
So what I'm going to do is tuck
well, now
up,
something a little bit different, sure Mark, on the BBC Graham Style Challenge. Let's take a look at the media start.
In there, and, you know, really the nice finishing products. So that's where I'm going.
And is there, I mean, you know, we didn't tell you that we were going to bring you on the show just to humiliate you, did we? But we're going to do it just a little bit further as well.
you wouldn't do that.
Well, it's possible that we can, actually, because I think we have a member in the audience with some rather marvellously coloured hair. Isn't Shane there?
Yeah, I don't trust him one bit.
Well, you know, we've got him mic'd up.
I don't trust him one bit.
Because, I mean, just looking at, you know, clearly you wear quite a bit of kit on the bike, and we'll talk about maybe the safety aspect of it, but, you know, you have been known to ride the bike in very little, haven't you? Where's Shane? What's he been up to?
There's a testimonial meeting last year for a rider, and we decided it'd be quite amusing to get out there with very little on, and that's what we've done.
I mean, how little?
He had a G-string on, and I had...
there's not much room for branding on that. So would you like to see proof of this? Because, in fact, there is proof. Someone did have a video camera, and... I think we've got something coming up. I can't wait.